The subcommittee hearing will come to order. The chairman notes the presence of a quorum, which under Natural Resources Committee Rule 3E is two members. The Natural Resources Subcommittee on Energy and Mineral Resources and the Agriculture Subcommittee on Conservation, Energy, and Forestry are meeting today for a joint oversight hearing to hear testimony on challenges facing domestic oil and gas development, review of Bureau of Land Management / U.S. Forest Service ban on horizontal drilling on federal lands. Under Natural Resources Committee Rule 4F, opening statements are limited to the chairman and ranking member of the subcommittee. In addition, opening statements will be offered today by the chairman and ranking member of the Agriculture Subcommittee, and should they wish to participate, the full committee chairman and ranking members of both committees. In addition, I ask unanimous consent to include any other members' opening statements in the hearing record if submitted to the clerk by close of business today. Hearing no objection, so ordered. I now recognize myself for 5 minutes for an opening statement. Today, the subcommittee is meeting to review the future of oil and gas development on federal lands in light of administration proposals to enact complete bans on horizontal drilling on federal lands. Earlier this year, the U.S. Forest Service of George Washington National Forest released a forest plan that had the administration's preferred alternative as a ban on horizontal drilling on more than 1 million acres of federal mineral estate. This plan, as proposed by the administration, would essentially close the entire resource to energy development, eliminate a key priority in the multiple-use mission of Forest Service lands, and further erode our efforts to generate domestic energy security. While efforts are proposed by the Forest Service to close these acres to domestic development of our own natural gas, the Cove Point LNG terminal operated by Dominion purchased nearly 9 million cubic feet of Norwegian natural gas just this year. Let me repeat that. While our Forest Service is working to close our American lands to all drilling, we are importing natural gas from Norway to meet the domestic needs of Virginia and Maryland. While the Forest Service is pursuing this ban on fracturing and horizontal drilling, BLM is in the process of holding hearings in the West to review the policies for the use of fracturing on federal lands, hydraulic fracturing. BLM Director Abbey was quoted earlier this year saying, quote, "We have not seen evidence of any adverse effects as a result of the use of the chemicals that are part of that fracking technology," unquote. This is important because a 2009 BLM instruction memorandum says that, quote, "application of directional / horizontal drilling technology is increasing. The BLM strongly supports this environmental best management practice as a means of providing substantial reductions in surface disturbance and overall impacts from oil and gas development," unquote. BLM says horizontal drilling is an environmental best management practice, and there is no evidence of any adverse effects. And yet the policy of this administration now appears to be an outright ban starting with 1.1 million acres in Virginia. The key questions for the committee today is, how did this policy proposal from the Forest Service reach this point? How did our land managers determine that the best policy is an outright ban on development, and what does this portend for the future? Americans are desperate for new jobs, and today's jobs report says that our economy continues to struggle with only 18,000 new jobs created in June. That is why it makes so little sense to ban domestic development here while we continue a dependence, in the case of Virginia and Maryland, on Norwegian natural gas. The Forest Service, as a custodian of our lands, has an obligation to work with a multiple-use mission to serve the people of Virginia and the United States by promoting the conservation of our resources, which undeniably should include the development of appropriate oil and gas resources on federal lands. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses today, and I now recognize the ranking member, Representative Holt of New Jersey, for 5 minutes for his opening statement.
Thank you. And will the subcommittee chair of the appropriation of the agriculture subcommittee chair and ranking also get
absolutely
comments?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. According to the title of today's hearing, there is a ban on horizontal drilling on federal lands imposed by this administration. Not true. Unfortunately, once again, this is a hearing title which amounts to a broad and misleading generalization, another case of blowing an issue far out of proportion to score what seem to be political or ideological points. In fact, the so-called ban in question is actually one of seven possible alternatives of a draft environmental impact statement issued as part of a required update of the land resource management plan for the George Washington National Forest. So let me reiterate, no decisions have been made on whether or not to allow horizontal drilling in the George Washington National Forest. Now, it's appropriate that we have a hearing on it. All that has happened, though, is that the Forest Service is evaluating the environmental impacts of a number of alternatives as required by law, and they should be looking at these alternatives. And we should be looking at them, too. None of the alternatives discussed in the EIS would change the existing practices of allowing traditional vertical oil and gas drilling in George Washington Forest for the, I forget how many acres that are already under lease, 12,000 acres already under lease. Furthermore, none of the alternatives, it appears, are going to, well, we will look at those alternatives. Horizontal drilling is commonly used in association with hydraulic fracturing, and recent investigations have raised questions about potential water quality hazards associated with fracking, and there's currently a study of potential effects being conducted by the Environmental Protection Agency. The counties of Rockingham, Augusta, and Shenandoah, Virginia, three of the largest agricultural counties in the state, have expressed their opposition to allowing horizontal drilling in the National Forest because of concerns about water quality. The city of Harrisonburg and Stanton, those cities have passed similar resolutions of opposition. To underscore the importance of being cautious about moving forward with hydraulic fracturing in this area, the George Washington National Forest protects a number of river basins, including the Potomac River that provides drinking water for thus, you here in Washington, D.C. Given the local concerns and the unanswered questions, the Forest Service, I believe, is acting responsibly with their proposed EIS and the procedure associated with it. While we wait for the facts to be assembled, which is the point I would want to make, even if the Forest Service were eventually to decide to prohibit horizontal drilling in the George Washington Forest, it should be based on facts, and we know it would not be a permanent ban. The Forest Service has made it clear that if natural gas can be accessed in nearby areas on private lands without adverse impacts to water quality, the service should consider and reconsider the issue. But banned or permitted, the decision should be based on evidence. The distortion in the title of today's hearing makes me wonder how grounded in evidence this discussion will be. Now, in the last 20 years, natural gas development on federal lands has more than doubled from 1.2 trillion cubic feet 20 years ago to about 3 trillion cubic feet last year. Moreover, according to the Bureau of Land Management, 90% of the new natural gas wells on public lands employ hydraulic fracturing. So overall, U.S. natural gas production is at its highest level ever. You know, the plans for terminals to import liquefied natural gas are being turned around because it's likely that there will be, for as far as we can see, export of natural gas. So those are the facts as I see them. I hope that we will restrict this hearing to, wherever possible, evidence and facts. I thank the chairman.
Thank you. I now recognize the gentleman from Pennsylvania, a member of this subcommittee, and also chairman of the Subcommittee on Conservation, Energy, and Forestry on the Agriculture Committee, Mr. Thompson, for 5 minutes for his opening statement.
Thank you, Chairman Lamborn, Ranking Members Holt and Holden. I appreciate your help and interest in holding this important hearing. Since its inception, the National Forest System has been intended for multiple use. This includes timber harvesting, recreation tourism, and, yes, mineral extraction, such as oil, gas, and coal. For an example, I don't have to look any further than the Allegheny National Forest, which is in the 5th District of Pennsylvania, which I'm privileged to represent. The world's oil industry was born there 151 years ago with Drake Well. And since its founding 64 years later in 1923, oil and gas production has continued in the nearby Allegheny National Forest. Some will have you believe that natural resource production, whether it's oil, gas, coal, or timber, and environmental stewardship are mutually exclusive. Nothing could be farther from the truth. And for those who think otherwise, I certainly invite them to Pennsylvania and the Allegheny National Forest to see for themselves. Through effective management practices, we have successfully produced oil, gas, and timber for decades in the ANF while protecting our environment. In fact, we boast of having the finest hardwoods in the world, and because of their value, I believe that the ANF is one of the few, perhaps the only national forest, that actually makes money for the Forest Service. Because we are blessed with abundant natural resources, Pennsylvania is again returning to its energy roots with the production of natural gas from the Marcellus Shale Field, which many experts feel is one of the largest gas plays in the world. The Allegheny National Forest is part of that play. Through modern technology, especially horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing, production of oil and natural gas from our many shale formations are now possible. In plain English, no fracturing and no horizontal drilling means no natural gas or oil from shale and no energy security. The Marcellus has brought us upwards of 100,000 new jobs to Pennsylvania alone, significant new tax revenues to the state, over $200 million to build new roads, none of that was taxpayer dollars, and an unimaginable amount of natural gas to the country. After only 4 years of production and being less than 10% developed, the Marcellus is already providing the entire Northeast United States with over 10% of its natural gas. Aside from the jobs, both direct and indirect, and the public and private revenue it creates, the shale boom is helping to stabilize the natural gas market in the United States. Access to affordable natural gas directly impacts consumers. Because of the production of shale gas brought by the horizontal drilling, our citizens could afford to heat their homes this winter, and the price of many goods produced from natural gas saw no increase in cost because of gas prices. Natural gas, which sold 4 years ago for record prices of over $13 a thousand cubic feet, has been stabilized to around $4.50. Dow Chemical and other petrochemical companies were set to move offshore just a few years ago because of high and unsustainable natural gas prices in the United States. Fortunately, because of our ability to produce shale gas through horizontal drilling and hydrofracturing, instead of moving offshore, Dow is now planning to expand its operations to the United States. Jobs. Make no mistake, our affordable and predictable natural gas prices are a direct result of our ability to produce it through horizontal drilling and hydrofracturing. Without a doubt, development will have its challenges, but I am convinced that we can meet these challenges and do it effectively as we have for decades. Knowing of our need for affordable and reliable energy, which we are blessed with in this country, I'm extremely concerned about the Forest Service placing a moratorium on applications for permits to drill any, quote, horizontal well and associated hydraulic fracturing, end quote. Not only does this undermine the service's mission of multiple use, but it also comes at a time when we're becoming more dependent on foreign sources and when world energy consumption continues to increase, while the federal government continues to stymie development of our own natural resources. Let's not forget that oil, gas, coal, and all minerals and timber on federal lands are not owned by the Forest Service, but by the citizens of our country and would greatly benefit from their production. Any action to prevent the development should be based on sound science and fact, not philosophy and not political agendas. The basic question I have regarding the decision by the Department of Agriculture and the Forest Service to place or propose a moratorium on even processing a permit to drill utilizing hydraulic drilling and hydraulic fracturing is when and why did they come to the conclusion that these processes should be banned in the forest? Did they perform environmental and economic analysis? Do they have any evidence that horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing are inherent threats to the forest, human health, or our water supply? It appears to me the Forest Service has no credible reason for moving in this direction. Now, I assume the Forest Service witnesses think otherwise, and they will present logical, science-based facts for their proposed moratorium. I do want to thank our witnesses in this first panel, Director Abbey, Deputy Director Haltrop, Director Ferguson, and Supervisor Heiser. We look forward to your testimonies and the opportunity to have a productive dialogue. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I now recognize the gentleman from Pennsylvania and the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Conservation, Energy, and Forestry, Mr. Holden, for 5 minutes for his opening statement.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I would like to thank our witnesses and guests for being here this morning. In times of global economic instability, it is important that the United States continue to move toward a secure energy future that will have long-lasting economic benefits. This must include safe and responsible domestic oil and natural gas production as part of a broad energy portfolio. While there is currently no ban or moratorium on horizontal drilling on federal lands, a draft management plan by the Forest Service proposes to not allow drilling on a parcel of land in the George Washington National Forest in Virginia and West Virginia. Following normal process for issuance of any forest management plan, this draft proposal is currently available for public comment and still open for revision. Drilling occurs on public lands every day, and over 5 million acres of natural forest lands are currently leased for oil, gas, coal, and phosphate mining. Both the Forest Service and the Bureau of Land Management have responsibilities related to the approval of oil and gas leases. Though the Forest Service has the option to object and veto a plan for forest land, more than 7,200 applications for permits to drill on public lands and Indian lands are expected to be processed this year by BLM, up from approximately 5,000 in 2010. America's public lands and their resources contributed more than $112 billion to the U.S. economy and supported more than one half million jobs in 2010, the bulk of which came from the management of mineral resources and recreation. The public lands managed by the BLM and the Forest Service are some of the nation's greatest assets, both environmentally and economically. I am hopeful that these agencies realize the economic importance of U.S. energy production. The natural gas industry has safely and responsibly been operating on taxpayer-owned lands for years. This responsible production of domestic fuel creates tens of thousands of jobs, raises more revenue each year for American taxpayers than it spends, and helps stimulate investment and innovation by businesses. I look forward to today's expert testimony and the opportunity to listen, learn, and question those in the forefront of this important issue. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. As each of the chairmen and ranking members of the full committees appear, they will be given an opportunity to make an opening statement. So I would now recognize the gentleman from Massachusetts, the ranking member of the Committee on Natural Resources, Mr. Markey, for 5 minutes for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. Recent advancements in natural gas drilling technologies have unlocked natural gas supplies in shale and other unconventional formations across the country, leading to a significant expansion of natural gas production, including on BLM-managed public lands. Currently, 90% of all new wells on public lands are hydraulically fractured. To explain the hydraulic fracturing process, the Talisman Energy Corporation came up with a cartoon coloring book that follows the friendly Fracosaurus named Talisman Terry through the natural gas drilling process. The lovable dinosaur playfully promotes the benefits of natural gas and paints a picture of a magical world filled with smiling rocks and grinning animals. The problem is that unless you are a Fracosaurus named Talisman Terry, this world does not exist. In fact, the word talisman means lucky charm, which is what everyone else will need if you listen to Talisman Terry, because in the absence of real safety procedures put in place, everyone will need a talisman, a lucky charm, an object with magical powers. And I understand why you would name your corporation that, but I don't think we should base our public health and safety laws upon that premise. For communities around this country, the expansion of natural gas drilling and hydraulic fracturing has meant contamination of water supplies, loss of property value, deteriorating health conditions, dead livestock, and destruction of pristine forests and agricultural lands. A recent series of investigative reports in the New York Times have highlighted some of the potential risks of natural gas drilling and inconsistent efforts to regulate this booming industry. For example, the Times reported that wastewater from hydraulic fractured wells is often contaminated with toxic heavy metals, highly corrosive salts, cancer-causing chemicals such as benzene and radioactive elements. A large amount of this wastewater is disposed in municipal sewerage treatment plants that are not capable of removing the contaminants. This wastewater discharge can also enter into local waterways, the equipment failure can cause tens of thousands of gallons of chemical-laced water to spew out of the well and into nearby creeks. These fluids are so toxic that a study by Forest Service researchers published earlier this week found that when fracturing fluids were spilled in the forest, they killed all plants and trees in the area. Without proper oversight, the disposal of drilling wastewater poses threats to agricultural lands, aquatic life, and human health, particularly when public drinking water systems rely on waterways where waste is being discharged. To further cloud the problem, the oil and gas industry enjoy exemptions or exclusions from key parts of at least 7 of the 15 major federal environmental laws designed to protect public health, air, and water, including the Safe Drinking Water Act and the Clean Water Act. Many of these companies have also refused to disclose the contents of their fracturing fluids. A century ago, when Congressman Weeks of Massachusetts guided into law the landmark legislation that allowed the lands that make up the George Washington National Forest to be purchased from private individuals, this protected forest land in habitat for hundreds of animals, which drives tourism for the local economy and provides a safe source of drinking water to almost 300,000 local residents. Even more so, although this forest is located in Virginia, it protects the source of water that feeds our faucets right here in Washington, D.C. While horizontal drilling has never occurred in the George Washington National Forest, expansion of these technologies without adequate safety and oversight could threaten natural resources and has the potential to turn stretches of forest into lifeless dunes, an environment that would only support the imaginary Terry the Fracosaurus. While the discovery of new gas resources creates a domestic energy and economic opportunity, and we should try to capture that economic opportunity, we must also ensure that this exploration and production of natural gas is done safely and responsibly and leaves us with a forest full of trees for another century and not a chemical wasteland. I thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you. We will now hear from our witnesses. I would like to invite forward the Honorable Bob Abbey, Director of the Bureau of Land Management, the Honorable Joel Holtrup, Deputy Chief of the U.S. Forestry Service, accompanied by Mr. Tony Ferguson, Director of the Mineral and Geology Management, USDA Forest Service, and Ms. Maureen Heiser, Forest Supervisor of the George Washington and Jefferson National Forest. Thank you all for being here. Like all our witnesses, your written testimony will appear in full in the hearing record, so I ask that you keep your oral statements to 5 minutes as outlined in our invitation letter to you and under Committee Rule 4A. Our microphones are not automatic, so you need to turn them on when you're ready to begin talking. I also want to explain how the timing lights work. When you begin, the clerk will start the clock, and a green light will appear. After 4 minutes, a yellow light will appear, and after 5 minutes, the red light comes on. At that point, I would ask you to conclude. Mr. Abbey, you may begin. Thank you all for being here.
Well, thank you, and Chairman and members of the subcommittee. Once again, it's my honor to appear before the members here to talk about the BLM's role in the responsible development of oil and gas resources from our public lands and the federal onshore mineral estate. Because there is no BLM ban on directional drilling, my testimony today is intended to provide an overview of our oil and gas leasing program and policies, which include implementing leasing reforms, planning for development in the National Petroleum Reserve in Alaska, continuing timely processing of drilling permits, improving inspection, enforcement, and production accountability, and reviewing hydraulic fracturing policies and practices. Secretary of Interior Salazar has emphasized that as we move toward the new energy frontier, conventional energy resources from BLM-managed public lands will continue to play a critical role in meeting the nation's energy needs. Facilitating the efficient, responsible development of domestic oil and gas resources is part of this administration's broad energy strategy that will protect consumers, help reduce our dependence on foreign oil, create well-paying jobs, and provide revenues and economic activity to communities. In fiscal year 2010, more than 114 million barrels of oil were produced from the BLM-managed mineral estate, the most since 1997. Also in 2010, the nearly 3 trillion cubic feet of natural gas produced from public lands made it the second most productive year on record. Federal oil and gas royalties in 2010 exceeded $2.5 billion, half of which were paid directly to the states where the development occurred. Leasing reforms that the Bureau of Land Management put in place in May of 2010 established an orderly, open, and environmentally sound process for developing oil and gas resources on public lands. These reforms focus on making oil and gas leasing more predictable, increasing certainty for stakeholders, including the industry, and restoring needed balance with comprehensive upfront analysis added to the process. In the 23 million acre National Petroleum Reserve in Alaska, the BLM has an active leasing program underway. Over 1.6 million acres are currently under lease in that area. The BLM has offered 6 lease sales in the NPRA over the last 12 years. We plan to hold a lease sale in December 2011 and each year thereafter. Through careful planning, the BLM's leasing program in the National Petroleum Reserve in Alaska ensures that exploration and development of its oil and natural gas resources is done in a manner that protects wildlife and habitat and honors the subsistence values of Alaska natives and rural residents. The BLM continues processing applications from industry for permits to drill on federal and Indian lands. So far this year, the BLM received over 2,600 applications for permits to drill and processed over 2,800. We recognize that oil and gas development is a market-driven activity. It is industry's choice as to when or even whether to start drilling a well within the 2-year period after an application for permitted for drilling has been approved. As of June 1st, industry has not yet started drilling on nearly 7,100 applications for permits to drill that have already been approved by the Bureau of Land Management. To improve inspection, enforcement, and production accountability, we have developed a strong technical certification program for all of our oil and gas field inspectors. Our personnel completed over 31,000 inspections in fiscal year 2010. These inspections ensure that lessees meet environmental and safety requirements and that the reported oil and gas volumes match the actual production on the ground. Recently, we've seen increasing interest in the use of hydraulic fracturing techniques to stimulate natural gas production. The BLM is proactively engaging the public, states, and industry on this issue. In April of 2011, the BLM held a series of regional public forums on use of hydraulic fracturing. Over 600 members of the public participated in these forums. Consistent with the framework presented by the President's Blueprint for a Secure Energy Future, the BLM is working to ensure that the potential oil and natural gas development on our public lands is realized. Mr. Chairman, again, it's a pleasure for me to be here, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that the members may have.
Thank you for your testimony. We'd like to now hear from the next witness, Mr. Holtrup.
Thank you for the opportunity to provide testimony today on challenges facing domestic oil and gas development. Accompanying me today is Tony Ferguson, our Directors of Minerals and Geology Management, and Maureen Heiser, Supervisor of the George Washington and Jefferson National Forests. To begin, I want to be clear, the U.S. Forest Service has no policy, nor do we have any plans to develop any policy to ban horizontal drilling and the associated hydraulic fracturing. I also want to emphasize that forest plans are place-based plans based on local community concerns, which we take very seriously. The Forest Service is committed to doing our part to contribute to the nation's energy goals while at the same time protecting the landscapes and watersheds that are precious to so many. The Forest Service and the BLM work closely in managing and delivering the mineral and energy programs in the United States. The agencies follow congressionally authorized mandates that allow for the responsible development of domestic energy and mineral resources. Generally speaking, the Forest Service manages the surface National Forest System lands, while the BLM manages the subsurface. The BLM issues leases for exploration and development of energy minerals after receiving consent from the Forest Service for leasing those National Forest System lands. The Forest Service bases its decision on whether to consent to leasing on guidance provided in our forest plans. Forest plans guide the management of National Forest System lands and are developed in an open process, gathering input from local and state government, interest groups, and private citizens. In the forest planning process, the agency strives to balance resource development with protecting the landscapes and watersheds that communities depend upon. The current oil and gas production on National Forest System lands is sizable. 16.7 million barrels of oil and 194 million cubic feet of natural gas were produced in 2010 from almost 3,200 federal wells on National Forest System lands. In addition, there are almost 12,800 additional wells located on National Forest System lands where the subsurface is privately owned, the majority of which are located on the Allegheny National Forest in Pennsylvania. In fiscal year 2010, production from federal wells alone generated an estimated $361 million in payments to the U.S. Treasury. A large portion of this revenue is returned to states and counties. The Forest Service is committed to providing these energy resources and their benefits to the American people in a way that is consistent with our mission to safeguard the health, diversity, and productivity of our nation's forests and grasslands. We understand that some members of the subcommittees are concerned about the draft forest plan for the George Washington National Forest in Northern Virginia and West Virginia that proposes several options for public comment, one of which is a preferred option that provides for oil and gas leasing, but would prohibit horizontal drilling and associated hydraulic fracturing in certain areas of the forest. This draft plan includes several alternatives which would allow for horizontal drilling. We will carefully consider all public comments prior to the regional forester making a final decision in the George Washington National Forest Plan. The Forest Service is accepting comments on the draft forest plan through September 1. As with all our forest plans, this plan is place-specific based on the particular circumstances of the George Washington National Forest and does not represent a broader policy with regard to hydraulic fracturing. There are no Forest Service discussions or efforts underway to develop a national policy to ban horizontal drilling. On the contrary, the administration believes that the recent technological advances that have allowed industry to access abundant reserves of natural gas, particularly from shale formations, provides enormous potential benefits to the country, as long as it is done in a way that protects public health and the environment. The Environmental Protection Agency is currently studying potential impacts to water resources from hydraulic fracturing, and a subcommittee of the Secretary of Energy Advisory Board is developing recommendations on practices and steps that can be taken to improve the safety and environmental performance of shale extraction. The Forest Service will move forward to allow the safe and responsible development of domestic oil and gas resources, consistent with the expert recommendations from these and other efforts. Thank you for the opportunity to provide information about the oil and gas program on the National Forests and clarify the situation related to horizontal drilling and associated hydraulic fracturing. I look forward to answering any questions you may have.
All right, thank you both for your testimony. A housekeeping note, we will soon be going to the floor as they call votes, and it will be a lengthy series of votes. So when that time happens, I will remind everyone that we will have to leave, and I'll set a time for us to come back, hopefully giving some certainty for everyone's schedule who are here today, especially those of you who are witnesses. In fact, they have just called votes. I think we have time to do the first couple sets of questions for approximately 10 minutes, two sets of five-minute questions. Then we're going to recess the subcommittee, and we'll set a time for coming back. So thank you for your patience. I wish this didn't happen, but we don't have any control over that part of our schedule. Ms. Heiser, as we have all read this morning, oh, and by the way, each member will be recognized for 5 minutes for questions, and I'll open up. Ms. Heiser, as we have read this morning, our national unemployment rate, unfortunately, has risen to 9.2% in June, with only 18,000 jobs generated nationwide last month. When you decided to include a horizontal drilling ban in your draft forest plan, did you consult with the Commonwealth of Virginia or anyone else for that matter on the impact that that would have on existing and future job growth in the energy development sector?
Congressman, first of all, I'd like to thank you for asking me to this hearing and giving me the opportunity to answer questions about the forest plan. We are in a draft comment period, and I want to let you know that the testimony and statements that are made today, the transcript, will be taken into consideration and part of the planning record. In answer to your question, early on, we understood and believed that energy development was very important in Virginia. And that's why we decided to go ahead and address the need to make lands available for oil and gas leasing. So that was a very important consideration for us.
Specifically, I asked, did job growth or job creation factor in at all to your decision-making process thus far?
Mm-hmm. We understood the relationship of energy development and jobs in Virginia, yes.
So you're saying you did take that into account?
And we will continue to take that into account, and we welcome additional information on that subject through the comment period that we can take into account in the final decision.
Okay. Did you seek to find out if there was any horizontal drilling or hydraulic fracturing going on in any nearby public lands that may have been done in a safe and proper manner?
In Virginia, there has yet to be any hydraulic fracturing done in the Marshall Shale in Virginia. So we did not have information available to us as to what the impacts would be.
And anywhere else in the country, even farther distances away, did you look at
the local basin?
What I think is a good safety record of hydraulic fracturing and horizontal drilling?
This is a local based plan. And so we focused our analysis and our information gathering on Virginia, and that's what our focus was, local base. It's a community-based plan.
Okay, thank you. Chief Holtrup, a recent study estimated that development of the Marcellus Shale added over 44,000 new jobs in Pennsylvania, $389 million in state and local tax revenue, over $1 billion in federal tax revenue, and nearly $4 billion in value added to the state's economy. Similarly, in West Virginia, it created over 13,000 new jobs and contributed over $220 million in federal, state, and local tax revenue, and almost $1 billion added to the state's economy. When proposing possible job-killing regulations or administrative actions, do you do a cost-benefit analysis on the outcomes of local job growth and revenues?
We do take into account the economic impacts and the implications of decisions that we make. Again, I would like to stress there have been no decisions made in the George Washington National Forest plan. It's a draft that's open for public comment at this time. But in the analysis of that or any other forest plan process that we go through, yes, one of the things that we take into account are the economic opportunities that are presented by the opportunities to do resource extraction or recreational opportunities. That's one of the things that we take into account, just as we take into account the environmental consequences or the concerns over the use of water or the concerns with water, et cetera. One of the things, I think another demonstration of the importance of the jobs and economics is in the draft forest plan for the George Washington, the proposal is to open nearly 1 million acres of the George Washington National Forest to oil and gas leasing.
Okay, thank you. At this point, I will yield back the remaining time, and I'll recognize the ranking member for any questions he may have for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Abbey, let me begin with you. Much of the concern about hydraulic fracturing fluids have related to the types of chemicals that are pumped into the ground and then come back out of the ground, sometimes with added contaminants, including naturally occurring radioactive materials. It's been reported that wastewater from hydraulically fractured wells in Pennsylvania and West Virginia have been sent to sewage plants that were not able to remove the radioactive contaminants, even though the levels were as high as 2,000 times EPA's drinking water standards. And then radioactive water was released into waterways, as it was reported. As a requirement for drilling permits on federal lands, does the BLM require assurance that radioactive wastewater will not be dumped into rivers or onto public lands?
Well, Congressman Holt, certainly water management is a big concern for all of us when we're addressing
specifically radioactivity as hydraulic fracturing out here.
The Bureau of Land Management issues our authorizations based upon the applicant being able to produce a permit from the authorizing local community or the authorizing officials.
So it goes to the state or local officials.
We defer to the
state. This is not a BLM criterion.
Exactly.
As a requirement for drilling permits on federal lands, does the Bureau require any radiological monitoring of drilling wastes for protection of either the public or the workers?
Again, we would defer back to the state or local government officials who have that responsibility.
Okay. In light of recent developments, do you plan to revise your regulations to ensure that drilling wastes are handled in a manner that doesn't lead to public or worker exposures to radioactivity?
Our current regulations addressing hydraulic fracturing on public lands and federal minerals are 30 years old. We're currently reviewing those regulations to determine what, if any, changes we'd like to make and pursue any new rulemaking that may be required.
Yeah, I hope you pursue that aggressively because we're in, yes, fracturing has been used for decades on a very small scale, but on this scale, this is new. And I hope you will pursue that. Mr. Holtrip, NEPA, one of the best features of the environmental protection law is it provides for American citizens to have input into the planning process, which was something that was lacking in previous decades. How did the Forest Service engage local stakeholders in the planning process? And in particular, I'm interested in the consideration, you were talking about economic considerations. I'm particularly interested in the consideration of agricultural jobs. Are you getting good input on that aspect? Let me interrupt you for just a moment. In my opening statement, I commented that several agriculturally intensive counties had issued public objections.
The process that the George Washington National Forest has gone through, as well as the process that occurs across the country during these forest planning processes, is very much, as you indicated, a public process, and we consider that one of the real positive benefits of the approach that we take to get that type of input. In the case of the George Washington National Forest, we did have public meetings throughout the area, the communities affected and interested in the George Washington. There are letters that we've received from three of the counties in the George Washington and two of the cities associated with the George Washington, all requesting that the Forest Service take a hard look at, or in some cases asking us to not allow horizontal drilling or hydraulic fracturing, et cetera. So taking those into account is one of those, not the only consideration, but certainly one of the considerations that we would expect our local managers to do as they're determining what's the right course of action on a forest planning process.
Okay. And just a quick question, Mr. Abbey. Under the Mineral Leasing Act, isn't it correct that no gas deposit shall be leased except with the consent of the surface managing agency?
That's true.
And that would be whom?
In the case of the George Washington, it would be the U.S. Forest Service.
Good. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Ranking Member. And we now will be in recess until 12:30. I don't have a crystal ball to know exactly when our vote series will finish. It is a lengthy vote series. The good news, it's the only one of the day. But to give certainty for all of you who came here, and we appreciate it, to give your testimony, as well as any other concerned citizens, we thought it would be good to give a time certain for reconvening so that you'll know we won't be here any time before that. So we'll reconvene at 12:30, and the subcommittee will now be in recess. The subcommittee will please come back to order. Thank you all for your patience. We did finish that lengthy vote series, and we're ready to get back into this important topic. The first panel is still seated. We appreciate your being here. We'll get to the second panel as soon as we can. And the next set of questions for up to 5 minutes is with Mr. Representative Thompson of Pennsylvania.
Thank you, Chairman Lamborn. Appreciate your assistance in coordinating this hearing. First of all, I want to ask permission to submit for the record. Permission to submit for the record and peace of mind for the ranking member of the Natural Resource Committee. It made some remarks regarding the radioactivity in the region regarding Marcellus Shale and horizontal drilling. And this is an article, June 21st, 2011, that reports on a March study that was done by the Department of Environmental Protection in Pennsylvania that found showed no radioactive contaminants in water used and produced. So in western Pennsylvania, where we do a lot of horizontal drilling. So if with your permission, I'd like to submit that for the record.
Without objection, so ordered.
I want to thank, first of all, the panel for your for being here and your testimony. I want to start with Mr. Holtrop with the Forest Service. Mr. Holtrop, on page one of your testimony, you state that, and I'm quoting, U.S. Forest Service has no policy, nor do we have any plans to develop any policy to ban horizontal drilling and the associated hydraulic fracturing. Looking for a yes or no answer in the following question. Does the Forest Service have a draft EIS dated April 2011 that states, quote, the Surface Management Agency, parentheses USDA-Forest Service, has a moratorium on processing surface use plan of operations of an application for permit to drill for any horizontal well and associated hydraulic fracturing. The moratorium will end May 1st, 2013. Is that correct that that exists?
Could you tell me what the title of that EIS is?
I sure can. It's the, I'm reading it from the Federal Oil and Gas Leasing Stipulations, Appendix 1, Draft EIS, George Washington National Forest, April 2011. And section 1, my quote comes from section 1, very prominent in the document, horizontal drilling moratorium stipulation.
So is this the George Washington Forest Plan document that you're referring to?
George Washington is noted on here in the heading.
Okay. So what that is it's an alternative in our draft forest plan amongst several alternatives that we are considering.
I'm trying to just figure out in my own mind then. So this wasn't an internal exercise. It was something that was a proposal being considered. And yet in your testimony, you said, nor do we have any plans to develop any policy.
Correct. What I'm referring to, there is no policy. The title of the hearing had to do with a policy on banning Forest Service ban on horizontal drilling on federal lands. My statement was intended to assure you that there is no intent for us to develop a policy nationwide, broadly. What we're talking about on the George Washington is a very site-specific, locally driven analysis as to, and there's a range of alternatives that we're looking for on the George Washington.
Okay. Well, it still sounds as contradicting. I did take from your opening testimony and Mr. Abbey's that frankly, horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing is something that is embraced, and I just find this, I assume that even the consideration of this, which really is developing a policy, you're developing alternatives for a policy you're in the process of developing, which really contradicts your testimony. The potential for a moratorium was prompted by specific occurrence in national forests of environmental degradation or damage from horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing. That's what I'm assuming. Were environmental and economic assessments conducted by the Forest Service prompting the proposed moratorium proposal or options or whatever we want to call it?
Yes, there's environmental analysis, there's been public input, there's a look at all the available science that we had available to us that led to the range of alternatives that we're looking at.
So based on the science and this, so there was actually evidence of environmental degradation and damage from horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing?
The concerns had to do with both the potential, whether there would possibly be potential effects on both surface water and groundwater resources, and there was concern over what might be the chemical makeup of the material following the use for hydrofracturing. There's a great deal of public input from a lot of interests asking us to take a good hard look at this issue, and so we're trying to be responsive to the public's request for us to do so.
And I understand public input, and I appreciate that Forest Service takes that option, but my question was, what's the data show? The Forest Service is involved in providing resources, and so obviously oil, natural gas, I know there's a lot of it pumped out of the Allegheny National Forest. I mean, is there data? Is there a track record? Is there established environmental damage and degradation that you had in documentation? Or were these concerns of what may happen?
I think probably the best way of answering that is as we're looking at the full range of resource values that we have that we're responsible for, that there were concerns that were raised that we felt it was important for us to consider a full range of alternatives that we ought to look at. We have every intention of using whatever data is available to us. If that data, if that science tells us that this can operate safely with public health and resource values accounted for, that is the determination that we intend to make. I think what we have with national forests across the United States, we have a recognition that there are great energy values on our national forest system. There are great other values as well, and there's not going to be one solution in each one of those situations that's going to be the right solution. We're going to continue to look at all of the resource values and all of the opportunities that come associated with those.
I'm just asking. I would ask that actually if you would forward to my office. I'm looking for the facts in terms of on forest lands where there has been environmental degradation versus speculation.
We will provide that information. We'll extract much of that from the environmental impact statement, and we'll look for other things as well to forward to you.
Thank you, Chairman.
Okay, the gentleman from Colorado is recognized for up to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate you holding this hearing, and gentlemen, lady, thank you so much for being here as well. I'm a Westerner, and so there are a few things that are very important to us, our public lands, access to energy, and truly to jobs. And just as an aside, Mr. Holtrop, when I read through your testimony, you noted about the importance and just spoke to it again of public input coming in, and really want to encourage you when you're looking off at closing off some of our forest lands that you do listen to that public testimony, particularly in Colorado. But to the points that we're dealing with in this particular hearing, we have some real confusion, and Mr. Abbey and Mr. Holtrop, if you could maybe answer this. We recently had Secretary Salazar before the Natural Resources Committee. I've been traveling in Colorado, met with BLM officials. They said that when the now defunct wildlands policy was going to be in place, that they were not going to allow lateral drilling. When we spoke to the state officers, they didn't know what the policy was going to be. Then the secretary indicated that no lateral drilling was going to be allowed. Can you clear this up? It seems to me that we have no basis to make any kind of a determination, and you haven't decided.
Well, thank you for the question. First and foremost, we do not have a wildlands policy at this point in time. We're not pursuing such a policy.
We appreciate that.
The Bureau of Land Management certainly recognizes the importance of horizontal drilling on public lands. It does lessen the footprint of drilling on these lands. It allows more wells to be drilled from a single location than individual wells being drilled vertically down. So I think both the U.S. Forest Service as well as the Bureau of Land Management recognizes the advantage of horizontal drilling. At this point in time, you know, as it relates to the public lands, we will continue to look at all opportunities that we have in responding to requests for applications to drill to see how best we can lessen that surface disturbance. And we'll look at those requests on a case-by-case basis. But as we indicated earlier, there is no ban on horizontal drilling.
When we're talking about the depth, and maybe you can illustrate this for us, how far below the water table does fracking take place? How deep are those wells below the water table?
It could vary from proposal to proposal. Most drilling that's being done using fracking technology is below the groundwater level.
Well below?
In many cases, well below.
Well below.
In the east,
right.
It might not be the case.
Sir, have we ever had any evidence of contamination of the water table from fracking?
The Bureau of Land Management has never seen any evidence of impacts to groundwater from fracking technology, from the use of fracking technology on wells that have been approved by the Bureau of Land Management.
So it appears to be safe.
Well, we've been using that technology for a number of years. As long as we're diligent relative to reviewing the proposals to ensure well casing integrity, to ensure that the design of the well borns are appropriate, to do the monitoring, working with the states and EPA to ensure that all the necessary permits are required and adhered to. Again, we believe that based upon the track record so far, that it is safe. Right. But that doesn't take away the need to continue to be diligent in reviewing each of the proposals and making sure that appropriate monitoring takes place.
Great. I really appreciate that, to hear the endorsement that it is a safe process. We do have to have the policies in place to make sure that we meet those safety and environmental standards, but it is safe to be able to proceed. So I do appreciate that, Director Abbey. Gentlemen, I've listened to several questions so far, and I don't believe I've actually heard the answer. Have you done a cost-benefit analysis?
An economic analysis is part of the EIS.
It has not been done.
Pardon me?
It has not been done.
There is a draft EIS available for public comment, and it includes a chapter on economic analysis.
Okay, and so that's in progress?
It's available for public review right now.
Okay, great. You know, as we were going through, you're establishing policy, and I think part of the concern is obviously going to be precedent that comes into some consideration here. And both the Forest Service and the BLM are moving under the authority that has actually been granted by the Congress of the United States in terms of the developing of these policies. Would you gentlemen be agreeable to coming back before this committee, the Agricultural Committee, the Natural Resources Committee, before going active with your proposed regulations to get them back to the authoritative body of Congress for their review before you go active?
Which regulations are you referring to?
Any regulation.
We believe that we have the administrative authority to pursue our own regulations and policies that...
Was that granted by Congress, sir?
It would be consistent with the laws that have been granted by
Congress. So would it be appropriate to bring that back to Congress for approval?
We would be happy to report back to you on our plans. I'm not sure we would be seeking approval.
I think that's curious. This body has been elected to represent the people of the United States, and you're acting under the authority of Congress. I think you might want to maybe actually consider allowing Congress to have some actual input as well, ultimately when we get down to some of the regulations. As I think probably every member has heard, we're spending $1.75 trillion a year right now in regulatory costs in this country. All regulations are not bad, but I think it would be very appropriate for your consideration to come back to the body that authorized your agencies to be able to review those regulations rather than assuming that you have absolute authority. So I yield back the balance of my time, sir.
Okay, thank you. The next person in the order of questions is Mr. Fleming of Louisiana.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Panel, I'm from the 4th District of Louisiana, Shreveport, Bossier City, DeSoto Parish. That's where the Haynesville Shale is. And only three short years ago, we had no idea really what the Haynesville Shale is, was, or would be in the future. And it's turned out that it's had a tremendous impact on our economy. $11 billion so far entering the economy, jobs, poor parishes that are now doing tremendously well economically. We see police departments, sheriff departments, infrastructure, all of these things being improved, local government, as I say, high-paying jobs with good income. And we're beginning to meet the country's needs in terms of natural gas, which, as you know, is the cleanest form of hydrocarbon that's now available. I can tell you that we have not seen any significant problems. And so it really is beyond me to wonder now with a 9.2% unemployment rate, with energy costs as high as it's ever been, and the country in such a desperate economic situation, and a technology which is 50, 60 years old, and is proven safe, and even the EPA in 2004 said was perfectly safe. Why in the world would we even be thinking about banning this type of technology, which is so essential, not just for gas, but probably for the future of oil as well, domestically? So my question, for instance, Ms. Heiser, what is the typical depth of drilling in horizontal, in the horizontal drilling process?
I'm not aware of that. We have no wells that have been drilled on the George Washington Jefferson.
But I mean in a typical gas well, gas shale.
I'm not familiar with
that. Anyone else?
I think it depends on what part of the country you're in. It's a real specific geologic formation specific. And as a general rule of thumb, most of the shale gas development that I've read about and not necessarily witnessed firsthand, there's usually a vertical well that's drilled anywhere 4,000 to 5,000 feet.
4,000 to 5,000 feet. Okay.
And then
where is the water table?
Again, that varies from different parts of the country. It can be in the first couple of hundred feet, or it could be down as low as maybe 1,000 feet, but right near surface.
So the horizontal drilling is often, in fact, usually five times the depth. Ms. Heiser, how many layers of casing is there as you bore down in the ground to get down to the horizontal level?
I'm not familiar with that information.
Okay. Anyone else?
It can be a number of layers, depending on the depth.
Typical.
3 to 4 with cement. I describe it as the old collapsible cup concept, mm-hmm. where they're just, you know, you start with the larger surface, and as you go down, there's more and more.
Right. I would say in our shale formation, typical is 6. And how many episodes are you aware where hydrofracking fluid has leaked into the water table through the casing?
I'm not aware of any.
Anybody?
That I can point to.
Anybody? Can anybody specify a single incidence of death as a result of a hydrofracking process and the hydrofracking fluid somehow contaminating the water supply? Anyone?
Not aware of it.
Serious injury?
No, I'm aware of any.
So if we're talking about billions of dollars of impact and the possibility of transforming our energy from an oil-based system that we have today to at least in part natural gas, and by the way, we in the United States have more natural gas than any place in the world, as it turns out, and this is a fact we only found out just in the last few years. If we have all of this potential available to us and no harm to anyone, why in the world would we be considered banning this process? Anyone on the panel willing to answer that question?
The purpose of us looking at the restrictions on the use of horizontal drilling on the George Washington National Forest have to do with issues around water use, the volumes of water that are associated with that, what would be the potential effects on surface water resources.
But we've been doing it for 60 years, sir, and we have no evidence that there's a problem. Why do we want to ban it first and then ask questions later when we've got 60 years of experience?
One of the things that I think are the input that we're getting in this through this draft environmental impact process is going to allow us to have additional information, helpful information for us to make
that
decision.
You've got 60 years, sir. How much do you need?
I believe the horizontal drilling technology is more recent than 60 years, but it
hydrofracking and 90%
hydrofracking has been around for 60 years.
Well, that's what we're talking about here.
Well, we're talking
90% of wells today require hydrofracking. We've got 60 years of experience, not one single death, no injuries even that I know of, and yet we're going to ban or potentially ban the use of hydrofracking and or horizontal drilling.
The preferred alternative in the plan that we're talking about allows hydrofracking with vertical wells. It's the horizontal drilling is what was...
It's no good without horizontal drilling, sir.
It's been used for 60 or 70
years. Well, yes, but the type of shale formations that we have today, you're going to get very little yield out of vertical wells. We have to go horizontal, and we're horizontal at 2 miles down, so, you know, you're already below the water table. You hit that through the vertical drill. So, if anything, it would be safer at the horizontal level. Thank you. I yield back. Mr. Flores of Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the panel for being here today. The jobs report that we got today confirms the impact of a couple of things. One is an out-of-control fiscal situation at our federal government. And also, very importantly, and I think it, taking a more precedence over the economy today is the regulatory overreach by our administrative agencies. And in that regard, there seems to be a process here that's out of control, and I want to dig into that a little bit more. But before I go there, I'd like to ask the three witnesses from the Forest Service, what was the target? Was it fracking, or was it horizontal drilling, or was it both? What was it you were trying to shoot?
We're trying to address the local government and community concerns with horizontal drilling and the excessive amount of water used in hydrofracking and the totality of the impacts of that, where the water comes from, what the water comes back out again, what do you do with that water, the effect on the infrastructure, the potential impacts on the infrastructure. So we looked at a full range of 7 different alternatives. That we could explore different possibilities on how to address the issues.
What
we're asking comment on.
What sort of facts and science did you use in coming up with that option? I mean, so you heard the local community say, well, we're worried about it. Well, you know, there does seem to be, you've got people like the New York Times writing about fracking, and I guarantee you they don't know anything about fracking.
Mm-hmm.
You've got over... close to 2 million wells worldwide that have been fracked successfully with any problems.
Mm-hmm.
But yet, we're trying to go after a problem when I'm not sure there's a problem. What were the facts and science that you used?
If I could, I think that some of the science that was used was the recognition that we had different geologic features on the George Washington than places where hydrofracking has already been successfully used with horizontal drilling. So we have a different geological situation in terms of the configuration of the shale, and so that was part of what went into the analysis. Also, what went into the analysis is there has been very little demand for this activity in that area because there seems to be more limited opportunities there. And as we're looking for ways that we can be responsive to the full range of public desires, which included no leasing, which included no oil and gas development from some of the local governments, what the forest came up with was a range of alternatives that looked at that full range so that we would have this type of a dialogue that we would be able to make a final decision from.
Was there going to be a dialogue? What I've seen from a lot of the rulemaking today is they'll get substantial numbers of substantive comments back, And those are all ignored, and the rules become final without change. I mean, is this something that, I mean, are you different than the other agencies we're seeing these days?
I will not say that we're different from the other agencies. I suspect many of the agencies are like us in that we pay a great deal of attention to the public input that we get. We analyze those input. I'd be happy to show you the type of analysis that we do when we do that site type of when we do that type of public input. I can also tell you every time that we do a draft forest plan, when we come out with a final forest plan, it's different than what was in the draft, based largely on that public comment.
Okay. So as I understand the option for the ban of horizontal drilling, vertical drilling is still an acceptable option. Is that correct? You haven't done anything
that alternative,
with that.
Yes.
But you do understand that the surface footprint of vertical drilling is much, much more invasive by a factor of anywhere from 2 to 10 times more invasive than horizontal.
Or more. We are aware of that. That is one of the reasons why we do recognize the values of horizontal drilling when the situation calls for it. And if that's the right situation here, we will continue to consider that.
And as I understand it, your primary mission is to protect the surface, right? I mean, BLM is responsible for subsurface. Am I correct?
Both, well, the BLM has authorities subsurface. We have authorities for the surface, but our shared responsibility and our shared desire is to protect water resources, both surface and subsurface, as well as all the other resource values.
Okay. Well, I hope that you pay lots of attention to the comments you get, because I assume that you're going to receive a lot of comments. Ban, if it is the direction you elect to go, is the wrong thing to do for this economic, it's wrong for the country from an economic standpoint, from a job standpoint, from an energy standpoint.
Thanks for the input.
I yield back.
Thank you. I recognize the gentleman from Maryland for up to 5 minutes.
Appreciate it, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for your patience and also for your testimony today. I appreciate your efforts to explain that moving with some prudence and careful thought with respect to this hydraulic fracturing and horizontal drilling does not constitute a ban, de facto or any other kind of ban. And I think that you've described very well the broad activity that continues to happen on federal lands with respect to development and production of our natural resources in terms of oil, in terms of gas, and so forth. I don't want any audience that's watching or listening to this hearing to go away with the impression that your caution, your willingness, or your desire to move in a kind of deliberate way in considering the potential harm from this doesn't have any support in reality out there. And so I'm aware, because I'm bringing particular attention to this as a representative who cares very deeply about the Chesapeake Bay and the Chesapeake Bay watershed, that there have been incidents and recent incidents that point to the potential harm that can come from the fracking process. There was not too long ago in Pennsylvania a blowout of one of these hydrofracking wells that resulted in a discharge of thousands of gallons of fracking fluids, which I think the record ought to, at this point, stipulate can contain a lot of toxic materials. My understanding is that even in those areas of the country that are cited as having 60 years of experience, and it was pointed out that you have to distinguish where this experience has happened, because you have different geology implicated in places like the Chesapeake watershed than you do in places like Oklahoma and Texas and so forth. So we shouldn't borrow lock, stock, and barrel the lessons from one part of the country and try to impose them on others. But even in those parts of the country My understanding is that there was a discharge line installed in connection with a fracking process operated by Chesapeake operating in Oklahoma and Texas that resulted in discharge fluid into the Washita River. Can you speak to the fact that there are instances out there that you're taking note of that suggest that there's potential harm that can come from the process, from the beginning to the end process, that is a good reason for you to want to step carefully in terms of whether you open these kinds of public lands to horizontal drilling? Mr. Abbey, and then any others who want to speak to it.
Well, again, I think that's an excellent question and comments that you raised. The increased use of hydraulic fracturing on both public and private lands has certainly generated concern among the public regarding its potential effects on water quality and availability. As I mentioned before, as far as the Bureau of Land Management, in our experience, we have not seen impacts to groundwater as a result of using the fracking technology on wells that we've approved. That does not take away the need to be diligent, as I mentioned before. You know, that's why we focus on the integrity of the well and also to make sure that the well itself is well engineered and designed. Because if there is going to be a leak, it will be during that, as part of that drilling process, and there is potential for the fracking chemicals to get into groundwater. That's why we put most of our focus on the casings and, again, the well bore, the integrity of that. At the same time, it behooves all of us to maintain diligence on the monitoring so that we are cognizant of any potential impact that might be occurring so that we could take immediate steps to rectify those impacts. I've read about some of the impacts that have been associated with fracking in the eastern United States. I'm not familiar with those particular cases, but it does, again, raise our awareness that we need to be very, very careful as we review these proposals.
If I could just add to that, the part of your question, thinking from the very beginning of the process to the end of the process, those are things that we are also continuing to pay attention to and think about, not only the source of the water and where the water is coming from in order to provide the material for the fracking and what would be the implications of the water coming from that source, but then the material afterwards. There are ways, and there's a lot of success in successfully disposing of that material, but it has to be, as Mr. Abbey has been saying, we have to be diligent in paying attention to how we dispose of the material following the hydrofracturing as well.
Thank you.
Okay, now the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Goodlatte.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and Chairman Thompson for holding this hearing. My congressional district in the beautiful Shenandoah Valley of Virginia seems to be the focal point of it, so I appreciate the attention brought to the matter. I have long been, as I think most people here have, been a long supporter of the use of natural gas. It's a preferred, for those who are concerned about greenhouse gas emissions, it has fewer emissions than some other carbon-based sources of energy. I'm also a big advocate of local input into decisions made by the federal government, particularly in the case of the management of the George Washington and Jefferson National Forests, which are both primarily located in my congressional district. I commend them for doing that. They've heard from some of my local governments on the issue, and I think that's important. But my understanding is that the Forest Service would have other ways to stop horizontal drilling in the national forest should a permit be requested. And I don't know that that has been received at this point in time, but should one be filed in the George Washington National Forest, would there be other ways of stopping horizontal drilling from taking place if you found that there were not the correct procedures or precautions being taken? Mr. Sarbanes, Mr. Abbey talk about the necessity, which I think is absolutely true, that you have to deploy good, safe technology to do this. On the other hand, the preferred plan of the Forest Service for the George Washington imposes a 15-year ban on the as the preferential way to address the concern. So what I would ask you, Mr. Holtrop, is why did the Forest Service feel that a 15-year ban was the appropriate way to go in their preferred plan, as opposed to looking at the science, looking at the technology that Mr. Abbey referred to, making sure that the drilling goes well below the groundwater. You're right, geological formations are different everywhere, but it's my understanding that there is horizontal drilling that takes place right now in the Jefferson National Forest to the south of the George Washington National Forest. Why a 15-year ban as opposed to taking other measures that would assure my constituents that this is being done in a safe way that will not disturb the drinking water that my local governments are concerned about, or other degradation of the land that certainly some of my constituents are also concerned about?
Thank you for that question, and thank you for your continuing interest and help in the management of the George Washington National Forest. I believe the best way to answer that direct question, and I'd like to add a little bit, is that I think as the forest weighed the variety of information that they had, in terms of the local input, in terms of the recognition of the high values of the water resources from the George Washington National Forest for millions of people, that as they weighed all of those, in order to generate the kind of input and the kind of interest in the topic, that was the right preferred alternative. But again, not a decision. It was to make sure that there was the appropriate type of continuing public input into the decision-making process, which is
yet to occur. Was there a safety or scientific reason for the Forest Service to place the ban? To propose placing the ban?
There was the science. We used the best science that's available to us at this time. I would prefer not to. Again, I would like to express again, there has not been a decision made, so there is not a ban. There is a proposed, a preferred alternative that considers that.
Let me ask you. I understand that. Let me ask you another question. Is there a difference in the shale formation in the GW Forest different than the Jefferson National Forest that would require such an absolute difference in approach?
Maybe somebody else can answer and I can fill in.
Did you want to take that one?
I think you may have the best answer.
Okay. The Marcellus Shale Formation under the George Washington is very folded and fractured. And over the last 30 years, there's been hundreds of thousands of acres there leased, but only 5 wells have been drilled, conventional wells, and they were not successful. On the Jefferson, it's a different kind of formation. It's more accessible. There are a number of wells there now, active wells.
Sure. Well, that makes it more attractive maybe that might also provide more assurance to my constituents that there may not be the activity that they're concerned about, because the formation may be different for that reason. But is there a safety difference between the two? And that, I think, should be the basis on which you would make a decision on whether to impose different regulations for drilling there as opposed to an outright ban there.
That's a point that we need to look into and consider.
I also understand that public input is important. It's important to us as representatives. It's certainly important for government agencies to take that into account, so I commend you for doing that. Yet some of the same localities that came out in opposition to wilderness, which is included in the plan, they came out in opposition to wilderness, and yet you've included wilderness in those same jurisdictions. Do you have a comment on why you responded to the localities and one issue but not the other?
We've been working with the counties on that issue also, and we have looked at what the potential is for wilderness in there and what's most suitable. We did not recommend a great deal of wilderness at this point. Again, we were concerned that we needed to have a real balance of uses and development activities on the national forests. We were concerned about jobs. We're concerned about energy development. So we looked at the broad range, and so we've continued to work with the counties, and we'll continue to work with them on that issue.
Good. Well, we appreciate that. On
could I just, Mr. Chairman, if I might?
I'm sorry.
Well, Mr. Oltrop.
Thank you. If I could just very briefly just add, the range of public input in those communities of interest that were providing input, some of them requested no leasing. Some of them requested no hydro fracturing whatsoever. The preferred alternative that was selected does open up 900,000 plus acres of the forest to leasing that was not previously available. It does allow hydro fracturing for vertical wells. There was a consideration of all those inputs. So I would say that what we've come up with the preferred doesn't totally meet.
Sure, and I think one of my colleagues made the point that with vertical wells, if you are going to go ahead with that route, it first of all requires more drilling, more surface disturbance than horizontal drilling. But also, if you allow hydrofracking with a vertical well, the issue there is even greater in terms of groundwater contamination. So I'm not sure your position is consistent in that regard.
I agree with all that what you just said. If the concern was the impact, the surface impact, that would drive the decision more. When the concern is the water quality, that's the determination we're making.
Mr. Chairman, if I might have Lee to ask one more question. Prior to proposing this ban in your preferred plan, had any companies approached the Forest Service about the possibility of obtaining permits for horizontal drilling?
Not to my knowledge. Okay. BLM? Any?
My recommendation would be that you anticipate that could happen and that you have good regulations that put in place the kind of protections that Mr. Abbey referred to, because this is a very common practice that takes place all over the country. Millions of wells have been drilled, and it is by far the most efficient way to extract a very important source of energy, and I would hope that you would take into account that a simple 15-year ban doesn't address it just simply punts. It doesn't take into account the need to have good technology deployed if you were to receive applications, and that might be the better route to go.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I want to thank the panel for their testimony. That concludes our questions. Sorry for the delay earlier. Thank you for your patience on that as well. I now invite the second panel to come forward. On that panel will be Maureen Mattson, Deputy Director of Natural Resources and Senior Advisor on Energy for the Commonwealth of Virginia, accompanied by David Spears, the State Geologist of Virginia, Mr. David Miller, Director of Standards for the American Petroleum Institute, Mr. Lee Fuller, Vice President of Government Relations for the Independent Petroleum Association of America, Mr. Craig Mayer, General Counsel for Pennsylvania General Energy, LLC, Ms. Kate Wolford, Executive Director of Shenandoah Valley Network, and Ms. Amy Mall, Senior Policy Analyst for the Natural Resources Defense Council. Now, before we seat this panel, I want to clarify an issue. Under Committee Rule 4A and House Rule 12-2G5, witnesses appearing in a non-governmental capacity are required to file with their testimony a completed disclosure form describing their education, employment, and experience, and provide other background information pertinent to their testimony. The purpose of this information is to help the members of the committee judge the testimony in context. Rule 4A of the committee indicates that failure to comply with these requirements may result in the exclusion of the written testimony from the hearing record and or the barring of an oral presentation of the testimony. Ms. Mall, recognizing that your invitation was extended late, your disclosure statement indicates a statement where you admit that it remains incomplete and that the information will be forthcoming. So before the committee seats you on this panel, will you orally commit to us that you will provide a completed disclosure form to this committee no later than close of business Tuesday, July 12th of this year?
We absolutely will commit to providing the disclosure form. I would not be providing the information myself. It would be our legal and financial staff, so I'm assuming they can do it by that time on the 12th.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Like all our witnesses, your written testimony will appear in full in the hearing record, so I ask you to keep your oral statements to 5 minutes as outlined in our invitation letter. Our microphones are not automatic, so you have to press the button to begin. The green light comes on with 5 minutes. Yellow light will come on with 1 minute, and red light at the conclusion of 5 minutes. And we will just jump right in. Ms. Mattson, you may begin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee. It really is a pleasure to be here. Since taking office 18 months ago, Governor Bob McDonnell has had a singular focus on rebuilding Virginia's economy. The citizens of Virginia, like the citizens of every state around the country, need jobs, first and foremost. To make certain that we grow our economy and create jobs in ways that are safe and environmentally responsible, we have made our state environmental regulators an integral part of our economic development teams so that we can successfully allow the development and use of Virginia's natural resources without sacrificing our clean air and our clean water. The focus on bringing new jobs to Virginia goes hand in hand with the governor's determination to make Virginia the energy capital of the East Coast. We are working every day to make Virginia's valuable energy resources, both onshore and offshore, available to meet growing energy needs and to secure high-paying jobs in energy development and in the supply chains that support that development. Since adoption of the 1990 version of Virginia's Gas and Oil Act, natural gas production has meant more than $2 billion in capital investment in Virginia, over $630 million in royalties, over $150 million in severance taxes paid, and all of that is in addition to mineral, payroll, and sales taxes paid to Virginia. Most important of all, the industry has created more than 3,000 jobs. And Virginia has been effectively balancing our economy and our environment for decades. Hydrofracturing has been used in approximately 1,800 wells, producing natural gas from shale, sandstone, and limestone formations in southwest Virginia since the 1950s. We are, today, as it's been noted, drilling wells in the Jefferson National Forest. Natural gas wells in Virginia are permitted through the Division of Oil and Gas of Virginia's Department of Mines, Minerals, and Energy. This group works closely in all well permitting with the Virginia Department of Environmental Quality to ensure that water withdrawals and disposal of produced fluids do not harm surface or groundwaters. I have with me today, in fact, a technical expert, Mr. David Spears, who is our state geologist and a former director of the Oil and Gas Division, to answer any questions you might have about our regulatory model and its enforcement. But I'll share with you a few of its important attributes. Our permit review process begins at the very beginning with research concerning the specific proposed well site. Our regulations do not allow any off-site impacts or discharges to surface waters. Our inspectors are on site for every critical operation leading to production and for reclamation. Our comprehensive regulatory scheme has protected Virginians and Virginia's environment for decades. Over those years, there have been no documented instances of surface water or groundwater degradation from fracking in Virginia. In short, Virginia has long experience with effectively regulating hydrofracturing. We are doing it safely, and we are protecting the environment and the health of our citizens. Virginia appreciates and values its spectacular national forests. Indeed, no one cares more for the preservation of Virginia's magnificent landscapes and the quality of Virginia's waters than Virginians do. Our regulators protect the water that they, their families, and their neighbors enjoy and depend on every day. The proposed ban on horizontal drilling, included in the draft revised land and resource management plan for the George Washington National Forest, if adopted, would represent an unprecedented interference with development of underground resources on federal lands. Restricting drilling in an area the same size as the current Virginia producing area will limit jobs and economic growth. We know of no justification, scientific or otherwise, for ending the effective collaboration between Virginia and the Bureau of Land Management and other federal agencies to provide access to those resources. In fact, horizontal drilling would allow access to the important energy resource under the forest with fewer wells and far less construction and disruption above ground that comes with the traditional vertical wells that have historically been allowed in the forest. Virginia is home to a valuable natural gas resource that ought not be put on the shelf and off limits. The proposed ban would harm Virginia and Virginians by burdening business and preventing job growth. It would undermine the nation's energy security by placing domestic resources out of reach at a time when global competition for energy resources is rapidly increasing. And it would do so without justification and without any identifiable or tangible benefit beyond the protections already accomplished by Virginia's well-established regulation of natural gas development. I thank you for this opportunity to be with you today, and I'm happy to respond to your questions.
Thank you for your testimony. And now, Mr. Miller, if you'll proceed with your testimony, please.
Good afternoon, Chairman Lambert and Chairman Thompson, ranking members, and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to address challenges facing domestic oil and gas development. My name is David Miller. I am the Standards Director for the American Petroleum Institute. You may know that API has more than 470 member companies that represent all sectors of America's oil and natural gas industry, and that our industry supports 9.2 million American jobs and provides most of the energy America needs. What you may not know is that API has been the leader for nearly nine decades in developing voluntary industry standards that promote reliability and safety through proven engineering practices. Our industry's top priority is to provide energy in a safe, technologically sound, and environmentally responsible manner. We therefore take seriously our responsibility to work in cooperation with government to develop practices and equipment that improve the operational and regulatory process across the board. API standard program is accredited by the American National Standards Institute, ANSI, the authority on U.S. standards, and the same organization that accredits programs at several national laboratories. API undergoes regular third-party program audits to ensure compliance with ANSI's essential requirements for standards development. API standards are developed through a collaborative effort with industry experts, as well as the best and brightest technical experts from government, academia, and other relevant stakeholders. For that reason, API standards are widely cited by both federal and state regulators. The committees that develop and maintain these standards represent API's largest program, with over 4,800 volunteers working on 380 committees and task groups. API standards are normally reviewed every 5 years to ensure that they remain current, but some are reviewed more frequently based on need. Overall, API maintains some 600 standards, recommended practices, specifications, codes, technical publications, reports, and studies that cover all aspects of the industry, including five guidance documents focused on hydraulic fracturing operations. These documents provide the blueprint for the environmentally sound development of natural gas. We have shared these documents with non-governmental organizations, state regulators, the Bureau of Land Management, and the Department of Energy. In particular, API has presented an overview of these documents to the Public Health, Safety, and Environmental Protection Work Group of the Pennsylvania Governor's Marcellus Shale Advisory Commission. API has also given presentations to industry conferences and provided training on these documents to staff members of the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection. We are available to provide similar educational opportunities to other interested stakeholders, and the documents are publicly available on our website at www.apr.org under the hydraulic fracturing page. Well construction practices covered in these documents are standard in the industry and enforced by virtually all states to effectively protect underground sources of drinking water from potential impacts related to oil and gas exploration and production activities, including hydraulic fracturing. The great majority of hydraulic fracturing activities take place at depths far below existing groundwater sources that could reasonably be considered underground sources of drinking water. And contemporary well design practices, steel pipes cemented to the rock through which the well is drilled, ensure multiple levels of protection between any sources of drinking water and the production zone of an oil and gas well. We look forward to providing constructive input as the subcommittees, the Congress, and in the administration consider the challenges facing domestic oil and gas development. That concludes my statement. I welcome questions from you and your colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Mr. Fuller, go ahead and proceed with your testimony, please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Committee on Natural Resources and the Committee on Agriculture, while today's hearing has been triggered by the draft environmental impact statement related to the George Washington National Forest, IPAA believes that the draft EIS presents broader issues. First, it reflects an inconsistency within the administration. While publicly emphasizing the importance of American natural gas, its regulatory positions in this draft EIS and other venues seek to limit the access and production of these resources. In the draft EIS, the Forest Service seeks to limit the use of horizontal drilling technology. It rationalizes these limitations based on surface disruption and water issues. Horizontal drilling technology is recognized as an option that reduces the surface footprint. The water issues are couched in the context of comparing the impacts of one horizontally drilled well to one vertical well, rather than one horizontally drilled well to the several vertical wells it replaces. The draft EIS clearly anticipates that a portion of the resource play underlying the forest is shale gas. Development of shale gas hinges on the use of two pivotal technologies, horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing. The draft EIS proposes a horizontal drilling ban that would prevent the economic development of this shale gas resource. If this type of rationale is applied to federal lands nationally, it will clearly limit the America's access to its resource base. It is completely unjustified. Second, the draft EIS follows a path of targeting long-standing, well-regarded technologies as the basis for limiting development. Over the past several years, there has been a national effort to thwart the development of American resources by attacking various technologies, principally hydraulic fracturing, to create anxieties in communities and to shift the decision-making process from managing environmental risks to prohibitions of technologies. Developing American resources is not easy. Drilling natural gas and oil wells is a capital-intensive process that involves sophisticated equipment. Equally important, it is a regulated action. Oil and natural gas drilling regulations have been developed since before horizontal drilling or hydraulic fracturing existed. Drinking water protections that require the use of steel casing cemented in place when the wellbore passes through water supplies were developed to protect these resources from exposure to oil and its produced water. Those protections remain in place and are regularly revised. They are the fundamental protections that apply to the use of hydraulic fracturing with or without horizontal drilling. Other environmental risks must also be managed. Produced water, water that is present in natural gas and oil formations, can be a significant environmental hazard, generally because it is extremely salty. State regulatory programs have been created to manage this risk, and both the Federal Clean Water Act and Safe Drinking Water Act regulate produced water management. If decisions on development of American natural gas and oil are based on managing the environmental risk, history demonstrates that regulatory systems effectively address the risks associated with oil and natural gas production. Consequently, the tactics of those opposing development have shifted. First, the technologies used to produce natural gas and oil are distorted. Second, the regulatory process and the regulators are demeaned. And third, federalization of the regulatory process or expanded federal regulations demanded. Hydraulic fracturing is an illustrative example. Recurring studies have concluded that fracturing is safe as currently regulated. But since it is a linchpin to developing America's large shale gas and shale oil formations, fracturing has been mischaracterized, distorted, and demonized. Because the regulatory systems create a barrier to movement of fracturing fluids from the wellbore to drinking water, the environment is protected from the fracturing fluids that are used, mixtures that are 99.5% water and sand. Consequently, rather than address the management of the fracturing process, production opponents have focused on the chemicals used in the 0.5% of the fluids. Producers do not oppose disclosing the chemicals used in the fracturing process, but because confidential business information is involved, the execution of disclosure is not straightforward. Weaving through these complexities, the state regulators have developed a national registry, Frac Focus, that producers strongly endorse. It will provide well-by-well information on chemicals, but production opponents will not endorse it. They demand federalization. This disagreement will continue with the key point that the regulatory process protects groundwater resources, since chemicals will always be a part of the production of oil and natural gas, a casualty to the anti-production rhetoric. Equally clear, production opponents regularly attribute any produced water problem to hydraulic fracturing. In recent years, produced water issues are characterized as fracturing fluids. They are not. If a rational debate on production is to take place, it must be based on a fair characterization of the issue instead of the distorted rhetoric that has become so prevalent. Thank you very much, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
All right, thank you. Mr. Mayor.
Chairman Thompson, Chairman Lamborn, thank you for inviting me to appear. By way of background, the Allegheny National Forest is located in northwest Pennsylvania, and it shares 93% of its 513,000 acres with owners of private oil, gas, and mineral estates, and has done so since the forest lands were first acquired in the 1920s and 1930s. The mineral development on this acreage is competently and rigorously regulated by the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection. When the Forest Service acquired these acres, as well as most of the 20 million acres of Weeks Act lands now found in 42 states, it purposely did not purchase the oil, gas, and mineral estates. At the very heart of the matter is Section 9 of the 1911 Weeks Act. It, along with other safeguards in the Act, severely restrict or preclude the Forest Service from controlling the exercise of mineral rights or any other property rights that it did not acquire when it bought the surface lands from private citizens. Because it now desires to control and even extinguish these rights, the Forest Service wants to effectively repeal and reverse the effect of Section 9, and has been attempting through various administrative maneuvers and artifices to do so. With respect to the Allegheny National Forest, this began in early 2007. To date, its actions have spawned 7 lawsuits, 1 administrative appeal of a forest plan, threats by armed Forest Service personnel to prosecute and arrest producers, 1 wholly baseless criminal charge, unwarranted and increasing delays in reviewing drilling notifications, decreased oil and gas production, and economic hardship for hundreds of individuals, families, and small businesses. Forest Service efforts to impede development activities have been persistent and hostile. The string of actions even include, and I'm not making this up, the regional forester for the eastern region organizing and appointing an Allegheny oil and gas strike team. In March 2007, in a forest plan revision, Forest Service officers secretly crafted and then imposed a regulatory regime on private mineral estates. Only costly administrative appeals forced the Forest Service to acknowledge it had acted illegally in concealing this and not providing for public notice and comment, and then to suspend application of its rules. In March 2008, to stop mineral owners from quarrying stone for road surfacing, the forest supervisor noting, remarkably, that the laws, regulations, and policies had simply been misapplied for the previous 85 years, asserted United States ownership of all sandstone and shell rock found on the forest. In December 2008, specifically in support of the then pending litigation, by this point in time, 3 cases had been filed. The National Office initiated rulemaking to impose a federal regulatory regime on private oil and gas estates. In April 2009, incredibly, at the height of the most severe economic recession since the 1930s, and again behind closed doors, it entered into an agreement with activist environmentalist groups to shut down new drilling across the entire forest. This was done in a sweetheart settlement agreement that included a very unusual clause, noting that the Forest Service just happened to possess unrestricted regulatory authority over private mineral estates. Fortunately, a federal judge, finding that the Forest Service did not possess such authority, issued a preliminary injunction on December 15, 2009, blocking any further implementation of the agreement and lifting the drilling ban. In early 2011, the Forest Service renewed its 2008 rulemaking effort. Again, behind closed doors, it is once again taking action to grant itself regulatory authority, along with drafting rules aimed at evading the December 2009 injunction by imposing costly and interminably lengthy NEPA requirements on wholly private development activities. In closing, I believe that all stakeholders can use our natural resources in a way that effectively provides for jobs, energy security, and environmental protection. And your subcommittees are in the perfect place to help us achieve that. This is not the time for the Forest Service to continue its efforts and to increase regulatory burdens on our citizens and small businesses. Thank you very much for taking your interest in these issues, and I'm prepared to respond to any questions.
Thank you. Ms. Wolford?
Thank you for the opportunity to comment. It's truly an honor for me to have the chance to be a witness this afternoon. My name is Kate Wofford, and I serve as director of the Shenandoah Valley Network. We work with local citizens groups to preserve rural lands and communities in the Shenandoah Valley. The network is a very small nonprofit. I'm the only full-time staff member. I hope today to provide the Valley's unique perspective on natural gas drilling, particularly the strong support among elected officials and area residents for a ban on horizontal drilling in the George Washington National Forest. Public lands on the George Washington make up a quarter of the land in three valley counties and serve as a source of local drinking water for a quarter of a million people in and around the valley. The forest provides many benefits to the region and to the country. Traditional uses like hunting, fishing, and hiking, as well as wildlife habitat and timber resources. Since 2007, long before natural gas drilling emerged as a possibility, the valley's elected officials and residents started asking forest planners to formally identify and protect the public drinking water source on the forest. Seven counties, plus numerous towns, cities, and civic groups, adopted formal resolutions urging the Forest Service to carefully manage drinking water quality and supply. Later, in 2010, when the Valley was faced with its first proposal for a Marcellus Shale natural gas well, the local leaders took a conservative and cautious approach. Rockingham County officials drove 5 hours each way to visit Wetzel County, West Virginia, where this type of gas drilling is in full swing. They took along one of the citizen leaders I work with, Kim Sandham. Not one person on the trip came back to Rockingham County and said, "This is an industry we'd like to develop here." In fact, local governments and the farm community have concerns that horizontal drilling may be incompatible with the investments that our region's traditional rural sectors and could actually do more harm than good. The Rockingham County Farm Bureau adopted a resolution this spring supporting natural gas development, but opposing high-volume hydraulic fracturing. Not surprisingly, when the opportunity to influence management of the public forest lands came up again last fall, localities in the valley asked the Forest Service to limit or ban hydraulic fracturing. Rockingham, Augusta, and Shenandoah counties, as well as city councils in Harrisonburg and Stanton, all wrote letters or passed resolutions. Numerous local citizens expressed similar concerns. Thankfully, the forest planners carefully studied the issue and responded with a proposal that reflects local concerns, a prohibition on horizontal drilling on federal lands, oil and gas leases. We have a landowner at the hearing here this morning in the audience, Mr. Everett May Jr. from Rockingham County, whose family has farmed land next to the George Washington for several generations. Mr. May signed a lease for gas drilling in 2006, thinking it would be a simple vertical well. Then he found out about the potential impacts of Marcellus Shale gas drilling, and he told me that he would give that lease back if he could, but he can't. So Mr. May and many of his neighbors asked the county supervisors to see that a conservative approach is taken on private lands. And they asked the Forest Service to make sure that this kind of gas drilling didn't happen on the George Washington. I believe that the local government and the landowner messages from the Valley on horizontal drilling were not intended to be political statements on oil and gas production on public lands elsewhere. They were directed to the George Washington, and they ought to be taken at face value. Citizens in the Shenandoah Valley have observed the impacts of Marcellus shale gas development in other communities and have decided that a cautious approach is warranted. That concludes my statement, and I welcome questions. And again, thank you for the opportunity to be here.
All right, thank you. Ms. Mall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I'm Amy Mall, a senior policy analyst with the Natural Resources Defense Council, or NRDC. NRDC is not opposed to natural gas as a fuel. Natural gas is cleaner burning than other fossil fuels and can help in a transitional role as our nation shifts to a cleaner energy future. But the nation's use of natural gas must be efficient, and natural gas must be produced by methods that best protect clean water, clean air, land, the climate, human health, and sensitive ecosystems. Cases of contaminated water, unhealthy air pollution, and scarred landscapes are too common in the rush to develop natural gas. Some say this industry is mature and has sufficient safety and environmental standards in place, but today's oil and gas well is not your grandfather's oil and gas well. Wells are deeper, drilling is more intensive, and there are growing concerns about impacts to wildlife, human health, communities, and public lands. The George Washington National Forest is an extremely popular location for hunting, fishing, hiking, camping, and other outdoor pursuits, and as was mentioned earlier, it's home to the headwaters of the Potomac River, which helps supply drinking water here in Washington, D.C. It appears that the U.S. Forest Service has correctly taken a precautionary approach in assessing the potential impacts from natural gas production on water and other natural resources in the George Washington National Forest before moving forward to approve any new drilling. While there is growing understanding of the environmental impacts of oil and gas development, much remains unknown. There has been little scientific investigation into the wide range of potential environmental impacts from this very complex industry. Federal agencies, therefore, have begun conducting their own inquiries into various aspects of oil and natural gas operations. For example, Forest Service research in West Virginia found that forests suffer permanent changes from drilling operations, including ineffective erosion controls and toxic waste disposal methods that killed vegetation. The researchers found that unexpected impacts could not be carefully controlled, planned for, or mitigated. The USGS, the U.S. Geological Survey, has found that the knowledge of how horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing might affect water resources has not kept pace with the expanded use of these technologies. The USGS stated that, this is a quote, agencies that manage and protect water resources could benefit from a better understanding of the impacts that drilling and stimulating Marcellus shale wells might have on water supplies. Clearly, many uncertainties remain, but drilling on federal lands continues to proceed apace across the country. The Bureau of Land Management has been approving permits, and there are more than 38 million acres of land onshore leased for oil and gas by the BLM. While some places may be appropriately protected, this is a small minority of parcels. We're concerned that current regulations as well as enforcement capabilities are insufficient. Federal environmental laws, including the Clean Air Act, Safe Drinking Water Act, and Clean Water Act, have gaping loopholes for the oil and gas industry that need to be closed. For example, the Clean Water Act definition of pollutant excludes hydraulic fracturing fluids under certain circumstances, and hydraulic fracturing is also exempt from the Safe Drinking Water Act. While the Department of the Interior has announced some new procedures to improve review of parcels proposed for leasing, something that we strongly support, the agency has not put the strong rules we need into place to require new practices that best minimize environmental impacts. Drilling on federal lands must also abide by state rules, but state rules are also woefully inadequate in most locations. For example, the West Virginia Secretary of Environmental Protection recently said that the state's regulations for Marcellus gas wells is, quote, inadequate, and that the agency hasn't fully considered drilling's aggregate effects on water, air, roads, public health, and safety. And this is not a partisan issue. A Republican candidate for governor in West Virginia recently stated that West Virginia needs new regulations to protect communities, state roads, and the environment. And it's clear from blowouts during frack jobs in Pennsylvania recently, there have been several in the last, I think, 2 years, that the industry does not always use the safest practices. States and federal agencies are also not staffed to fully enforce the current laws on the books. Virginia had less than 10 enforcement staff in 2008 for 6,000 wells. West Virginia, most recent report was that there are 12 inspectors for 59,000 wells. And the GAO reported earlier this year that the Department of the Interior continues to experience problems in hiring, training, and retaining sufficient staff to provide oversight and management of oil and gas operations on federal lands and waters. In conclusion, it's clear to us that we need more science and research, stronger rules, and better enforcement to protect the public health and our natural resources from the risks of natural gas development.
We urge the committees to work with others in Congress and make sufficient funds available to federal agencies to ensure they have the resources they need for these essential activities. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Now we will have questions from the members of the committee. Members are limited to 5 minutes for their questions. I now recognize myself for 5 minutes. Ms. Wolford, you talked about wanting a ban on horizontal drilling, and I'm sure you understand that when you drill down and then go laterally with horizontal drilling, you can go great distances. In fact, I think recently a record was set of 9 miles from the vertical well itself. But you can go at least thousands of feet, sometimes miles. So you can have a single pad with multiple wells on it, as opposed to 10 or 20 or more vertical wells scattered throughout the surrounding countryside. Wouldn't you prefer one pad as opposed to 10 or 20?
Thanks for the question. I would say from the perspective of communities in the Shenandoah Valley, the concern isn't necessarily just the single footprint of a well pad. The concern really is the whole process that's associated with shale gas drilling, starting from the exploration all the way through to the wastewater treatment. And I mentioned the field trip that officials took to Wetzel County, Pennsylvania. Some of the impacts that they saw there go well beyond the footprint of a well pad. It is the impact on the landscape from well pads and compressor stations, but also the pipeline infrastructure, the heavy truck traffic carting chemicals and sand and cement in and out of sight.
Okay, but your objection is to the horizontal process.
I think the concern in the Shenandoah Valley, sir, is really towards the entire process of shale gas drilling.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for your honesty. Ms. Madsen, I'd like to ask you a question or two. You say that Virginia is interested in becoming the energy capital of the East Coast, and job creation here in Congress is a huge concern of ours, especially given the abysmal and discouraging job report that we heard this morning. If the proposed horizontal ban on Forest Service lands was finalized, what would that do to future energy jobs in the Commonwealth of Virginia?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for that question. We don't have precise numbers, of course. It's speculative to know what would happen, but I think we can look at the more than 3,000 jobs that the industry is supporting in Southwest Virginia today and understand that the area being produced in Southwest Virginia is about the same size as the area that would be in which production would be banned in the forest, and perhaps extrapolate from those facts that we are looking at the missed opportunity, shall we say, for thousands of additional jobs in Virginia.
Okay, thank you. And could you respond to a statement made by one of the other witnesses that the states playing a role in regulation have a poor record in most cases, according to one of the witnesses? I'm not sure I agree with that. Could you respond to that in the case of the Virginia perspective?
Absolutely, sir. I certainly can't agree with that. We have, as I said in my remarks, no experience with water quality degradation in Virginia through decades of hydrofracturing and even the perhaps single decade of the high volume hydrofracturing in Southwest Virginia. Not a single experience. Now, not to jinx our luck, and I can certainly turn to my expert to my right, but we are diligent. There's been a lot of discussion today about being cautious and being conservative and being diligent. Virginia and its regulators are all of those things. And we have a comprehensive regulatory scheme that goes from site examination to casing plans all the way to reclamation to make sure that the interests and resources of Virginia and Virginians are well protected.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Miller, I'll conclude with you. Interestingly, and I have a quote here from the Director of Natural Resources Defense Council, Mr. Ralph Kavanaugh, quote, if the industry can meet high standards of environmental performance for extracting and delivering the fuel, we are looking here at very good news for America's economy and industrial competitiveness, the environment, and our nation's energy security, unquote. Can the industry meet those high standards that will lead to the good news that Mr. Kavanaugh says in his quote?
Yes, thank you very much for the question. We certainly believe we can. We have a long history of developing these industry standards and best practices. They're widely used throughout the country. They're widely cited not only in the state regulations but also in the federal regulations many times over, and we have a large community of experts that develop these documents, as I mentioned in my testimony. So we feel that this strong foundation of technical work provides the blueprint that we're all looking for.
Okay, thank you very much. My time's up. I'll yield to the ranking member for 5 minutes.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Mattson, what is the largest industry in the state of Virginia, in the Commonwealth?
Agriculture, sir.
Yes. As I understand it, about 350,000 jobs in the Commonwealth.
Yes, sir.
Do you know the top five agricultural counties in the state?
They are right there in the valley. Yes, sir, of course.
Yeah. Three of the top five have actually commented on this subject. Let me mention a few things that I have here. County of Shenandoah, I may quote here, in the revised management plan, the Board of Supervisors asks that the Forest Service act to aggressively protect drinking water resources by prohibiting hydraulic fracturing natural gas wells. Do you disagree with the elected officials of Shenandoah County?
I certainly do not disagree with their caution.
Okay.
It is understandable that they would want to proceed carefully.
However,
I'm not
County.
Aware of any threat to their drinking water from this practice.
Okay, Rockingham County is has also commented similarly, does not support these activities. Do you disagree with Rockingham County?
Well, we do,
the,
sir.
The leaders, you
in
do.
That, as I say, we agree with their desire to proceed with caution. This is an unfamiliar practice to the folks in the county. It has been going on in Southwest Virginia for a long time, though not in the northern part of the state. And we
okay.
look forward to engaging with our public
officials. Now, Augusta County Board of Supervisors, quote, does not support hydrofracking as has been proposed. Do you disagree with the elected officials of the county of Augusta?
We do support hydrofracking.
And the city of Harrisonburg, Virginia, you disagree with the council there when they say the Forest Service should act aggressively to protect drinking water by...
Again, we are not aware that this will...
And you also support, you support or do not support the declaration of the town of Stanton, I believe this is, yes, the Stanton City Council, asking the Forest Service to act aggressively to protect the drinking water by prohibiting the horizontal hydraulic.
If acting aggressively means a ban, sir, we would not support.
I see. All right. Thank you. Now, these are not what you would call politically liberal bastions. We're not talking about Berkeley, California, or Cambridge, Massachusetts, are we here?
No, sir.
No. Okay. All right. Thank you. Ms. Mall, you mentioned that the USGS found that knowledge of how horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracking might affect water supplies has not kept pace with the expanded use. You go on further to say that the problems in hiring, training, retaining sufficient staff to provide oversight and management exist, and that we need more understanding and better enforcement of in the area. So it sounds like you see some lack of knowledge on how to proceed. Given that, do you think the Forest Service should move ahead with the horizontal drilling, hydraulic fracturing, in the absence of this understanding and in the absence of this kind of enforcement?
Yeah, absolutely. We think a lot more science and research is needed. That's why we support the EPA's investigation into the potential risks of hydraulic fracturing on drinking water. Also, the Department of Energy is looking into this, and as we heard earlier...
But the question is, do you think they should allow these technologies to proceed in the absence of this knowledge?
We think that there are places that absolutely should be off limits because the risk is too great and the unknowns are great, and that would include drinking watersheds for significant populations like the headwaters of the Potomac River. And it sounds like the Forest Service, I have not read the complete draft environmental impact statement, and as was stated earlier, these are place-based and they're specific to location, but the discussion of the fractures and the faults underground, the drinking water sources that are there, and the other important values in the forest, it sounds like they are on the right track.
Thanks very much. My time has expired, Chairman.
Okay, you're welcome. We will now take one of the members of the committee out of order because he has a funeral to get to. Mr. Goodlatte of Virginia is next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your forbearance. One of my constituents from the Shenandoah Valley who gave his life in Afghanistan is being buried at Arlington National Cemetery later this afternoon, and I do want to be there. So I appreciate the opportunity to ask questions of the witnesses before I depart. Let me start with Ms. Madsen. I've heard from these counties as well expressing their concern about what takes place in the national forest. It's my understanding that not to the same degree that we have in the Allegheny National Forest in Pennsylvania, where 97% of the mineral rights are owned by private individuals and only 3% by the forest. So the forest land is owned by the government, but the subsurface rights are primarily not owned there. But in the George Washington National Forest, it's my understanding from the National Forest that 16% of the land, or about 180,000 acres, are owned by private entities in terms of the subsurface mineral rights. So if one were to proceed in those portions of the national forest, that land would be subject to your regulation, would it not, and not to the Forest Service's regulation?
I will look to my expert to confirm, sir, but as far as I, my understanding is that that would be true, yes, sir.
Okay, so you would impose the state's requirements, and I share your concern, and I share the concern of the local governments that good standards be imposed before any kind of drilling takes place. And we haven't seen this in the Shenandoah Valley. We have in other parts of Virginia. And I suspect that's in part because there's a lot of uncertainty about whether there is an economically viable deposit in the area. But if there were determined to be one, for that 180,000 acres, this process that we're talking about here where they're banning it would not apply to those acres. So the question I have for you is, do you think that it would make good sense for the Forest Service to work on good technology and procedures that would be applied on their portion of the land and to work with the state and to the extent the federal government has input here on making sure that good practices are imposed because they can't stop it on those 180,000 acres anyway?
Yes, sir. I absolutely agree that there is a path short of a ban that allows us to develop those resources carefully and cautiously that would protect the interests in the forest.
And I share the concern of those local governments with regard to the quality of their drinking water and making sure that any chemicals used in the hydrofracking process wouldn't be allowed to get into the drinking water systems of those governments. But they have jurisdiction over the remaining private land in their area with regard to certain zoning regulations and so on that they can impose. Have you heard from any of those jurisdictions that they have banned horizontal drilling or attempted to ban it in their jurisdiction on those private lands?
No, sir, I have not. They have declined to act on some interest that has been expressed, but in terms of adopting a ban going forward, no, sir, I have not.
So they've taken a case-by-case approach they want to be cautious. I know that, for example, there was one application made in a floodplain, and obviously that would generate some concern with regard to how those chemicals might get into drinking water if you had a flood or some other event like that. But they have not taken the position that there would be no countywide ban on horizontal drilling on private lands. Their focus has been imposing this ban strictly on federal lands, and as we've just pointed out, it wouldn't be an entire ban anyway, because there would be lands where the subsurface mineral rights are still retained by private landowners. So, again, I get my question to you is, given the desire on the part of some, including myself, to make sure that we are using the newest and best technology, and that we are making sure that there is not degradation of the land or the water resources of the counties that I represent, would it not make more sense to have a progressive approach to looking to using those newest technologies, as opposed to a 15-year ban, which would not be 100% effective to begin with, but also would not allow for the same kind of considerations that they are making on county land, on private lands in the rest of the county, on these public lands in the national forest?
Yes, sir, absolutely.
Thank you. Those are the only questions I have, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And we will now revert to the regular order of members of the committee. Mr. Thompson of Pennsylvania.
Thank you, Chairman. One of the witnesses noted that this isn't a grandfather's oil and gas industry. I couldn't agree more. In my congressional district, I have Drake Well, 1859, and I've been there. In fact, my district office is, I won't say it's within a walk, but it's within a hike of that. And frankly, I've been on a lot of Marcellus Well sites as well. And in my office, for those that, how many of the panels have been to a Marcellus Well site? Great. I encourage those who haven't to do that. In my office, if you don't get that far, just walk to 124 Cannon. We'll show you a picture of the Drake Well and a 2010 Pennsylvania General Energy well as well there. It is different. The science, the technology, the standards, the oversight by the states, it is absolutely different. I want to just share, in terms of the EPA, Administrator Lisa Jackson stated that there is no evidence to suggest the process of hydrofracking contaminates water. And just some assurance, my friend from Maryland is not here, but he didn't allude. He specifically said that, I guess, those of us in Pennsylvania are contaminating the Chesapeake Bay. And I want to be very clear about that. The blowout that he was talking about, specifically the environmental testing after the incident, found that there was limited and very localized environmental impact with no adverse effects on aquatic life in Towanda Creek. So I assure you, if there's no adverse impact on Towanda Creek, there's nothing in the Susquehanna River and nothing hundreds of miles away in the Chesapeake Bay as a result of that. The previous panel had a lot mentioned a lot about the importance of public input from the Forest Service, and I can't agree with that more. So, Mr. Mayor, I want to public input within the communities of the National Forest obviously is important. What's your been experience living and working within the Allegheny National Forest? The ability to provide input and how they receive or use that input?
I think it would be, with respect to oil and gas development, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Well, at this point in time, because of the litigation and the injunction, the officers on the Allegheny National Forest are really not inclined to engage in dialogues. They simply participate in the course of the individual notifications that come from the companies in order to work through the consultation process, which has been the practice for the last 85 years and has been so done successfully. So, on a broad scheme in terms of talking, you know, like on a program basis, for example, with the Oil and Gas Association, there really isn't engagement. but on the individual level with regard to a particular project, there is, and it's typically very constructive because you're working usually with, professional oil and gas administrators from the Forest Service at that level.
It's my understanding that that the production of shale gas is subject to 8 federal laws and 11 state laws. Mr. Mayor, is that true from your perspective?
I couldn't begin to count the numbers of laws, the numbers of agencies, and people with oversight, frankly, Mr. Chairman. But I'm certainly, I would be feel confident that 8 is certainly a confident number to rely on.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Fuller, what in your opinion would be the net effect on our domestic energy supply if a ban on horizontal drilling were carried out across the national forest system?
Well, it's difficult to know without knowing exactly the extent of resources in the national forest system, but in those places where shale gas or shale oil underlies national forest lands, essentially the economics of developing those types of resources hinges on the use of horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing. That technology has evolved, particularly over the past 5 to 7 years, to allow us to now have the prolific development we've got in the Marcellus Shale and other shales around the country. So to suggest that limiting access to vertical wells would allow for the same type of development, I think, is inconsistent with the reality that it takes the combination of the two to really develop these new and very extensive shale formations.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, Mr. Fleming of Louisiana.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Wolford, you're here today. I get a sense that you're speaking for the people of Shenandoah Valley. Do you speak for them here today?
No, sir. I think I'm here to provide a perspective that I've observed from the Valley.
Okay, so really you're speaking for yourself.
Yes, and I feel confident speaking for the Shenandoah Valley Network and our member organizations that work in the local
community. But you haven't brought any surveys or data. There's been no votes on the issue.
I have brought with me 5 resolutions from local government
and
a resolution from
the
Farm Bureau.
I'm not talking about governments or government officials. I'm talking about the people. I assume hundreds, thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people. There's been no survey.
Sir, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Has there been any survey? I mean, I'd love to have that data if you have it here today.
I'm confident that the elected
officials. No, I don't want to hear what you're confident about. I want to know the data. Do you have any data? Yes or no?
No, sir. No.
Okay, you have no data.
Done.
Okay, Ms. Maul, I can't see your name completely from here, so I apologize. Now, you indicate that there is inadequate data on safety. Now, again, we've established this is a technology that's been going on 60 years. It does come under the EPA. EPA in 2004 said it's perfectly safe. We don't have again, I've asked the question before. I've asked it many times in this committee room. Not one single person has been injured or killed from hydrofracking or horizontal drilling that I'm aware of. Nobody else. So it would seem to me that the burden is on you to tell us what is the technology where is the science that it is damaging the environment or is damaging or hurting people? Do you have that data here today?
Congressman, I do want to mention one case in Ohio where the state
found... Well, excuse me, I want to get plenty of questions in. I don't want anecdotal information.
No, this is a state investigation that found groundwater was contaminated due to 3 contributing factors, one of which was a frack job, which what they call went out of zone. There are other cases around the country where the state regulators have clearly found that oil and gas operations contaminated groundwater. We feel that they never asked the right questions to answer whether or not fracking was a contributing factor in those other cases.
Okay. Have you brought the science on that, the study, the engineers evaluating? I mean, obviously, for instance, there's this video that's going around, or I guess it's a quasi-documentary about natural gas seeping into water supplies. We find out when you actually apply science to it, that is something that happens naturally in nature.
It does happen naturally in some cases, but state agencies have found that some methane in groundwater was caused by oil and gas operations
in Colorado and in Pennsylvania. Well, let me throw this to the rest of the panel. Can anyone here answer that? My understanding is there's not a single proven case. I'd love to hear your response.
It depends on whether you're talking about fracturing or you're talking about methane. Fracturing, there have been no cases indicating that the fracturing process has caused a problem of contamination to drinking water or groundwater. Methane contamination is something that can occur as a result of the structure of a well. Its important factor is as you're casing and cementing the well in place and as you're drilling through formations that you have to isolate those zones. That's not a static process. Wells have to be maintained. Wells have to be carefully constructed. If there's a flaw in the steel, if there's a flaw in the cementing, that allows a pathway to occur that can bring methane into groundwater. It's equally certain that methane can be there naturally and can come from other types of formations. So the issue at hand is always trying to determine what's the source of the methane. If the source of the methane is from an oil and gas operator's well, he's responsible for fixing it, for stopping that from occurring. It does occur. It has been investigated by state regulators. They do occasionally find the problem, but in most of the cases that have been publicized extensively, those have generally been from non-oil and gas well sources. Put it in this context, we have around 1 million oil and gas wells operating in the country right now. We're drilling about 20 to 35,000 a year. We have a few of these anecdotal cases that show up, and they all are investigated by the state regulators, and they make a determination as to what remedy has to be made to fix them.
Right. And are you aware, sir, of anyone who's been harmed or even fatally harmed as a result of leakage of methane?
I'm not aware of anyone that's been harmed by the leakage of methane associated with oil and gas operations. Now, obviously, methane is also natural gas.
Obviously, this does happen naturally. You know, we talk about oil spills in oceans, but the truth of that matter is that most of the oil that's in the ocean seeps through the ocean floor naturally. So we have to keep all of that in context. And lastly, Ms. Madsen, you indicate that wells are regulated on a state level. In my state, we have, at least in North Louisiana, we have 12 full-time regulators from DEQ who are monitoring what's going on in all these wells. So is it correct to say that this is an unregulated industry?
No, sir, it is not.
Okay.
And in fact, I would say that Louisiana does a wonderful job of regulating their industry. I have had the opportunity to meet with and talk with your Secretary of Natural Resources, and we think very similarly about the balance and the important balance between protecting our environment, our economy, and our energy resources.
And you are subject to federal laws in your state, our states.
Thank you.
Thank you. I recognize the gentleman from California for up to 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I know we're in the second panel and a lot of the question has been asked. I think it's appropriate that the two committees do spend some time, especially in light of the fact that I think we're going to utilize more and more natural gas as a cleaner source of energy, and clearly with the abundance of the Marcellus Shale and the reserves that now seem to be proven to be over 100 years will provide a lot of benefit to this country. And it's incumbent upon us to ensure that we do it as safely as we can. As some of you know, I represent a significant portion of Kern County, and if it were ranked as a state in the nation, people don't often think about this from California, but would be the fourth largest producing oil production in the nation. As a matter of fact, California I know a lot of my colleagues have various views on offshore drilling, but we have 25 platforms offshore, and we have a lot of slant drilling in California. And California, with 38 million people, produces 47% of its own oil needs. That gets overlooked. And if we didn't do that, we would be obviously in a much more difficult situation. We also have 20% of our energy as renewable, and we're trying to, by the year 2020, strive to 30% as renewable energy. So we are trying to balance our portfolio. It's my understanding that the Bureau of Land Management earlier today in the Forest Service testified that they have no intention of banning horizontal drilling or hydraulic fracturing on federal lands. Is that clear, Mr. Chairman? I guess I'll ask that question through you since that was at the previous panel. Mr. Chairman? I'm asking a question through the chair. Since I missed the first panel, I understand that BLM testified and the Forest Service that they have no intention on banning horizontal drilling or hydraulic fracturing on federal lands. Was that testified today?
Well, Mr. Abbey indicated that, but nevertheless, we have this preferred alternative sitting there right now in the George Washington Forest, where that exactly
this administration, like every previous administration, I think sometimes finds itself in contradictory sort of positions. So I've been made aware of the Washington situation and the proposals there. But I think as a policy, we're going to have to continue slant drilling and fractionalization if we're going to take advantage of these energy sources and use all the energy tools in our energy toolbox, as the bipartisan legislation that Congressman Murphy and I and others have introduced. And I think that while you from time to time have problems with wells, that's why we have regulations. That's why we need to always be scrutinizing this process to ensure that we can convince the public that we do this as safely as we possibly can. That's a responsibility that I think government has at the federal and state level, as well as the energy companies have, to ensure that they're using state-of-the-art best management practices. Mr. Fuller, would you say that's the case today?
I think the industry, a combination of things. One, the industry's regulatory structure that it operates in imposes a substantial set of requirements to assure that the protection of environment and public health are undertaken in the course of developing processes. As it should be, absolutely.
Right. And we're and doing this in the shadow of the massive spill in the Gulf.
Right.
In which there's a lot of skepticism.
There is skepticism. There's always going to be some skepticism. There's always going to be questioning about any regulatory system. But it's a system that's arisen over multiple decades, long before there was hydraulic fracturing, long before there was horizontal drilling, that's put in place a series of particular protections that are imposed on each driller. In addition to that...
My time is running out, though. So.
In addition to that, you have efforts like the ones that have been undertaken by the American Petroleum Institute for 9 decades, I think, said, that create technical guidance documents and industry standards that the industry also tries to adhere
and,
to.
And we need to continue to update those and ensure that they're the best that they can possibly be in the world.
Absolutely. In fact, the EPI has just done 5 of them and updated 5 of them.
One quick question. I don't know if the chair will allow me the time because mine's expired. I don't know if it was stated in earlier testimony, but the potential we've talked about with the discovery of the significance of the Marcellus Shale and other finds, the potential impacts for natural gas. And it is the energy du jour, as I like to say, in California these days, because we have a lot of air quality problems in closed air basins. But I'm still a bit at a loss as to why we don't have greater utilization, notwithstanding the resource of natural gas throughout the country. Could you try to explain why?
Well, natural gas really grew after World War II.
I understand.
And as that growth expanded, you did see a huge extension of natural gas into residential commercial operations. At that time, there was the wellhead controls on gas, and it eventually suppressed its development. Those came off during the 1980s, principally, and we saw an increase in natural gas. At that point in time, we were dealing principally with conventional formations, to some degree unconventional formations like tight sands and coal bed methane. And as we hit about 2000, we started seeing a real challenge in being able to grow the natural gas market, given the kinds of natural depletion rates we were having in the conventional formations. Along about 2005, we really saw the emergence, the beginning emergence of the development of shale gas. So for the next, now the next 5-6 years, we've seen the identification of shale gas formations across the country, a wide number of formations. We're seeing the development of those formations. I think two things. One, as analysts are looking at those formations, they're now projecting that we have about 100 years of potential natural gas supply in this country.
That's based upon the current use?
Based on current use, which would
so
also
if we
allow...
If we doubled the increased use, then we'd have a 50-year...
We'd have a 50-year supply. The second aspect of that is, I think, the using industries, manufacturing, chemicals, are now realizing that this is a real source of supply. After watching supply being somewhat constrained in early 2000s, price going up, you saw the chemical industry in particular and other manufacturers being very concerned about the reliability of the resource. I think that's changing. We're now starting to see chemical companies looking at building new operations in areas like West Virginia to take advantage of the natural gases.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. You've been generous with your time, and the witness obviously could be pretty good at filibustering if he needed to be.
I've well, worked in the Senate at one
point. This is not a Senate hearing, so.
No, I don't think so, but he's obviously had some practice.
Okay. I did work in the Senate at one
point. As we start to conclude here, the gentleman from Colorado.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to yield my time to Congressman Flores.
Mr. Flores.
Thank you, Mr. Tipton. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Witnesses, thank you for joining us today. I know it's not something you'd like to be doing on a Friday afternoon. First of all, Ms. Mattson, what is the unemployment rate in Virginia today?
Holly, those new numbers just came in, so if I don't get the new number, forgive me. But I know that we are about 2 points under the national average, and I want to say just at about 7% unemployment.
And how about the Shenandoah Valley? Do you have those metrics?
I'm afraid I do not.
Okay. Thank you. Mayor, can you tell me about the process that the Forest Service used to develop these 7 options, if you know what it is? If you don't, just say you don't know.
They're using the forest plan process. It's their planning process.
Okay.
Wherein various options are put forward for purposes of being assessed or evaluated.
I mean, how were they developed? Did they hold hearings, or did they go to each community and say, tell us what you think about drilling in the George Washington National Forest?
Well, all I can speak to is my familiarity with what they did in the Allegheny National Forest and revising the forest plan there. I would assume it's the very same process. And they simply go about seeking public input and conduct a series of public meetings, as well as getting, you know, data and so forth, and periodically, you know, through, of course, the technology with the Internet, are able to update and keep people informed of what is going on.
I'm going to move on. Ms. Walford, did the Forest Service come into the Shenandoah Valley to the counties you mentioned and the communities and hold public input meetings?
Yes, sir. There are a series of public meetings.
They did. Okay. And did you participate in those?
Yes, sir. I did.
Okay. And Ms. Mall, did you participate in those as well?
No, I did not.
Okay. Did you provide testimony, Ms. Wolford?
Yes, sir. We've commented several times on the forest plan.
Okay. Can this committee get copies of that testimony?
Certainly. I'd be happy
okay.
to provide
it. That'd be great if you could do that. Ms. Mall, is your organization involved in any litigation with the Forest Service on drilling?
Yes, sir.
They are? Yes. Okay. I mean, one lawsuit, several lawsuits, how many?
I'm not a lawyer. I'm not involved in litigation myself. I would say probably several at any time.
Okay. How many with respect to the George Washington National Forest?
Actually, none that I know of with the George Washington National Forest.
Okay. And Ms. Walford, your organization, is it involved in any litigation with respect to the George Washington National Forest?
Sir.
Okay. I'm glad to hear that. The issue that was raised by the last panel seemed to be more related toward water. Even though one of the options was a ban on horizontal drilling, they sort of, instead of trying to address the problem, they shot another innocent bystander. What about, I mean, what, Ms. Walford, what do you think the problem is here? Is it water or is it something broader?
I think it's both. I think water is certainly part of the concern, but I think the concerns are broader. In Rockingham County, for example, said that they would be open to seeing this type of energy development on private lands if it's done in the appropriate place with appropriate regulations. But please, not on our public lands, the forest lands that provide so many other uses and benefits, like water supply to local communities.
Okay. Ms. Maul, you made several claims regarding the USGS saying that the science wasn't there, which I wholeheartedly disagree with. You said that there weren't enough regulators in various states. I don't know what scientific basis you have to make that claim. But what, just hypothetically, under what circumstances would you find drilling for oil and gas in the George Washington National Forest to be acceptable?
Well, I think there are probably some places where we would think it's not acceptable due to the risk.
Is that the case here?
In some locations. Now, there are many technologies that are available to the industry that allow it to operate in much cleaner and safer ways than it generally does. In most cases, we
such
see,
as?
For example, using the most stringent well construction standards. That is typically stronger than what most states require, and in most cases, my understanding is, the companies tend to comply with the state rules at a minimum and not always go beyond to what we know they can do that's safer. Capturing air emissions during a frack job, because there can be very toxic air emissions, that's another thing we know companies can do, but they don't always do. So there are a list of things, in addition to how they manage the waste that comes out of the frack job, which can be quite toxic. There are a list of things we know companies can do that they don't adopt uniformly across every operation. That would be a starting point, is to really know that the absolute safest practices were in place.
So just theoretically, if a company or an organization did do all of these things you're talking about, would you find it acceptable to drill in the George Washington National Forest?
I think it would depend on location. Every spot is different, how close it is to a water body, whether it's a steep slope, whether it's the middle of a hunting ground. There are lots of different criteria to take into account, but certainly we're not opposed to all drilling every place.
I'm glad to hear that. Okay. I yield back.
Well, thank you. That concludes our questions. I want to thank each of the members of the panel for being here. Thank you for putting up with our delay earlier. Members of the committee may have additional questions for the record, and I would ask you to respond to these in writing. Is there any further business before we conclude? Mr. Holt.
Chair. I'd like to ask unanimous consent to submit, to include in the record, two articles written by Ian Urbina of the New York Times about wastewater quality issues associated with hydraulic fracturing. And before my colleagues jump to say, to ridicule these as not being scientific peer-reviewed articles, I would comment that they appear to me to be well-researched and well-documented about, for example, radioactivity detected in the water. And I thought it was important to include them in the record because in response to some comments I made earlier, one of my colleagues included, asked to have included in the record an article from the Pittsburgh Tribune Review saying that in a small selection of wells, there was no radioactivity found, even though only 6 of the 14 drinking water plants submitted test results. The state had asked 25 wastewater treatment plants for results which were not included. So my point is, this is also a newspaper article that doesn't have a thorough scientific basis, which only goes to illustrate the point that witness Small was making, that there's a great deal to be learned yet. Thank
okay,
you.
Without any objection, so ordered. And if there's no further business, Mr. Flores?
I meant to ask one more question. I don't know, this may be grossly out of order, but I was wondering if Ms. Ball could provide her testimony that she provided to the Forest Service when talking about drilling to the on the George Washington National Forest.
Right. That would be probably her testimony. You're,
Did your organization provide testimony at these public input?
Yes. No, we have not.
You did?
Okay. Now. Sorry.
Disregard.
Okay, the committee will stand in recess. Or will be adjourned.